evening, or shall I say, good afternoon, sports fans. What's going on? Welcome to another edition of The Defining Moment, right here on IE Sports Radio, your direct feed for all that is sports. Well, here we go, y'all. Though the sports world may currently be in a slow-moving state with no sports at the moment, well, that doesn't mean that we don't get some kind of March Madness, as the NFL is providing plenty of madness. Oh yes, we got players going back to play for former coaches. We got players going back to play for specific teams, Saints, and we also have the greatest quarterback of all time, Tom Brady, heading on over to the Tampa Bay Buccaneers. Oh yes, ladies and gentlemen, we have one amazing NFL free agency underway, and the craziest part is it's not even underway yet. It's not underway for another hour. Welcome everybody, this is me and boy AB. For the next few hours, it's gonna be some fun stuff, talking sports, and of course, the man of the hour will be here momentarily as I interview the man, the myth, the legend, Coach David Patrick, head coach of the UCR Highlanders, as we talk about the success of those Highlanders this year and give you a very optimistic look for next season. Once again, you are tuned in live to The Defining Moment right here on IE Sports Radio, your direct feed for all that is sports. Welcome, 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 sports fans. Well, here we are. It's a rainy day here in Southern California. But I'll tell you what, it's certainly a sunshiny, happy day in the NFL for many teams. But some teams probably look like this right now, nice and gloomy and dark outside. I'm just being real, y'all. This has been an incredible last couple of days in the NFL, and there's been not one play ran. Yes, you know what time it is, y'all. NFL free agency, and we are talking absolute chaos. It has been completely insane, all right? It is confirmed that the greatest quarterback in the history of football will now be wearing the pewter in red. Yes, Tom Brady, head on over to the Buccaneers, which is absolutely crazy. But I'll tell you what, that's going to be pretty interesting to see him wear those colors and to see him plug into a division that is extremely difficult. He will be playing twice a year, he'll be playing Matt Ryan. He will be playing, of course, the young man who had a possible career-ending injury, came back, showed why he is still as potent as ever, and now he has his own team, Teddy Bridgewater, playing for the Carolina Panthers, and we get to see two legends who, there are no doubt in my mind that both these men will be delivering speeches one day at Canton, Ohio, and getting fitted for their NFL Hall of Fame golden jackets. That, of course, is Drew Brees taking on Tom Brady twice a season, at least for the next season or next couple seasons. I am so excited, and we have ourselves one incredible we have one incredible NFL free agency going right now, y'all. I can't believe this. Malcolm Jenkins going back home to play. I mean, home in the NFL. He was drafted to the Saints, and Sean Payton recalled him now, and that's going to be awesome to see him wearing that gold and black again. And there's just so much, y'all. I mean, this is insane, all right? I'm loving this. Vic Beasley getting another chance, going on to play for Mike Vrabel. We got Matt Patricia signing every Patriot possible. I mean, that should be a freaking acronym. I mean, S-E-P-P. Sign every Patriot possible for Matt Patricia right now, y'all. That's exactly what it is, because these dudes are going off, man. Everybody wants to go home and play for their coach. And you know what? I love it. And what I'm talking about is Matt Patricia. He's bringing home a lot of his guys, and that's going to be huge. We got Jarrell Casey departing from Tennessee to go play for the Denver Broncos, which is going to be absolutely huge. I mean, there is so much going on. Clowney right now is currently looking around, I'm sure, to see wherever he may land. I thought for sure he would stay in Seattle, because that's actually a pretty good fit for him, but that's going on right now. I mean, literally everything. Got Derek Watt going to play with his brother now. TJ Watt on the Steelers. That is pretty awesome. I mean, we have some really, really, really cool stuff going on right now in the NFL. I mean, and I'll tell you. So today we're going to do a few different segments. We're going to have some fun with y'all today. I'm going to be talking in my new segments today. I got two of them, actually three of them, to introduce to you today. The first one is gonna be called, and y'all gonna like this one, Are You Tripping? And we're gonna have some fun with that one later on, because, yeah, I have some things to say about Nick Foles going to Chicago that others may not agree with. So I'll be talking about that. I'm also going to be talking in my other segment called I See You and Carolina Panthers. I see you. So trust me, we're going to be talking all about that coming up. And then in the final segment coming up for today is going to be Bring It Home. And we're going to be bringing it home, wrapping it up all together. We'll be doing that at the end of every episode of The Defining Moment from now on. So hey, we got a new feel, y'all. We got a new feel, a new look. I hope you liked our new theme music. We got all kinds of new stuff going on here on The Defining Moment. And kick back, relax, and enjoy the show, y'all. We're going to have some fun stuff going on right now. And we are really going to, we're going to enjoy it, y'all. Trust me. We got that going on today. Canelo is going to be fighting Triple G coming up, maybe, in September. We'll see. The Olympics, as far as we're concerned, are still on, which is cool. We got that going on today. Well, we got that to talk about. We got, unfortunately, in IMSA, the 24 hours of Le Mans has been pushed to September, rather than June. That's gonna be really crazy. We got all that going, and of course, in just a few moments here, ladies and gentlemen, we are going to get ready to bring in, as I mentioned, the man, the myth, the legend, the guy who has single-handedly, because of course he's going to always give credit to his players, because he's just that kind of a guy. But in just a few moments here, I'll be interviewing head coach of the UC Riverside Highlanders men's basketball team, Coach David Patrick, will be joining me right now in a few minutes to talk about the success of the Highlanders, starting things off with a huge victory over the Nebraska Cornhuskers, first game of the year. And UCR will actually record their best season, tie their best season, that is, in their D1 stint, if you will, since they've been a D1 program. So all that to come on today's episode of The Defining Moment. Sit tight, y'all. When we get back, we'll be talking with Coach Dave Patrick of the UCR Highlanders. Once again, you're listening to The Defining Moment right here on IE Sports Radio, your direct feed for all that is sports. We'll be right back after this.
Drivers, start your engines. Auto racing takes many forms, from the close quarter contact of NASCAR
to the high speed, high risk atmosphere of IndyCar,
all the way to the pinnacle of technology with the Formula One World Championship.
No matter if you prefer the high banks of Daytona,
the concrete canyons of Long Beach,
or the flowing curves of the Nürburgring,
the international language of motorsports is simple. Go fast,
run hard,
and come home first.
So join us, myself, Daryl Kinsey Jr.,
Lolita Camello,
and Michael Ward,
on a world tour of all the best motorsports has to offer on the Extra Mile, Thursdays at 7 p.m. Eastern, 4 p.m. Pacific, only on your home for all that is sports, IE Sports Radio.
Wrestling fans in the podcast world, you are in the right place to listen to the right show, the premier show in the professional wrestling podcasting world. This is Ring Rambling Radio, and you are listening to one of the co-hosts. I am Martin Sandoval, a.k.a. the SoCal Saint, along with my two co-hosts, the lovely Felicia and my boy Matt. Yes, every Saturday or every other Saturday morning, you can listen to us, the premier wrestling team, giving you the premier wrestling news, rumors, updates, event discussions, everything that has to do with professional wrestling. You're in the right place. IE Sports Radio presents Ring Rambling Radio. Don't miss it, because it's just too sweet!
Good day, folks. Yours truly, Nico Green here, reminding you, tune in to the Neutral Zone Hockey Talk Radio Show, Tuesdays, 4 p.m. Pacific, 7 Eastern. Proudly brought to you by IG Sports Radio. It's the Neutral Zone. All hockey, all the time. Take care. See you soon.
What up, all you boxing fans? This is Vince Wright, the sports governor, and me and Gilbert Batista are the host of Ringside on IE Sports Radio. Make sure you keep it tuned to IE Sports Radio, Spreaker.com for the latest edition of Ringside. All the boxing news you need right here. Keep it tuned, Spreaker.com, IE Sports Radio, your direct feed for all that is sports.
That is right, ladies and gentlemen, your direct feed for all that is sports. Ladies and gentlemen, as I mentioned earlier and as I've been super excited about since yesterday, I am so glad to have this man back on the show here today. It has been 14 months since he was last on the show. We talked right in the middle of UCR's season last year, first year for Coach David Patrick, and well, guess what? This year was certainly one to remember, and I could not be more excited than to, number one, have followed those Highlanders this year closer than I ever have, and on top of that, to also have him back here on the show. So without further ado, ladies and gentlemen, as I mentioned earlier in today's show, he is the man, the myth, the legend, and I will say that about him all day long because what he has done is incredible, and I cannot wait to see what's coming up in the future for UCR basketball. Ladies and gentlemen, once again, welcoming here for a second time, and hopefully not his last time by a long shot here at IE Sports Radio. Ladies and gentlemen, welcoming head coach of UCR men's basketball, Coach David Patrick. How's it going today, Coach? How you doing today, man?
Hey, Larry, how are you? That's a great introduction. I need to have you come to our games and introduce me.
Hey, Coach, anytime. I'm such a fan of yours, man. I really am. And you know what? It's always hard when I'm doing these interviews to not be a fanboy, but I'll tell you what, I don't care, because your career has been awesome. I mean, I'm telling you, just looking at your career, you know, last time we talked all about your everything, you growing up with basketball, you playing basketball, you going on to be a coach, where you were before, and now here at UCR, and I tell you, man, I love it. I love these types of stories, and you are not just a great coach, in my opinion, you're an inspiration, not only to the young men that you coach, but of course, to everybody who follows you in your career, and people like myself who just really enjoy great stories. So once again, Coach, welcome to the show, and thank you again for taking the time out today to talk to us.
No, of course, and under these trying situations, our nation, country, and world is feeling it's good to, you know, just step out and get away from all that's going around in society at the moment.
Absolutely. It's definitely something. I'll tell you, yeah, absolutely. Right now, we got this craziness going on that I'm just hoping goes away soon, because it unfortunately took away from all sports, including the great game of basketball, and I'm just totally bummed out that we don't have March Madness this season. But, you know, Coach, I'll tell you right now, I know I don't want to keep you forever today, but I do just want to ask real quick off the bat, man, we have had just a very, very tough year to start out with, and now here we are with all this chaos going on in the sports world. With this whole bit of COVID-19, I mean, right now, Coach, I mean, really, what are your, I don't know, what are you thinking for the sports world right now? Are you thinking, well, we could be getting going soon if things get controlled, or do you think we just may not have sports for the rest of the year just to make sure that everybody's safe? What do you think personally?
Look, I think most importantly, it puts life in perspective, and sports a big part of most of our lives are in this work, in this field. But, you know, ultimately, you know, life is bigger than sport, and that's what I've tried to use this time to speak to my team about. That as much as we're all sorry that we're not playing in March, the most important thing is not only the health of your team, but the health of everybody around you. And so it really makes you take a step back and look at your fellow citizens and understand that as much as we want to win and lose, the game of life is so much more important than just any ball game.
Absolutely, and I couldn't agree more, Coach. You know, as I mentioned, I play professional football, lower tier, playing in the indoor league, and they canceled our season too. And I keep on saying, you know, I want to be out there right now. I want to be playing. I want to be training. I want to do all this. But you know something, Coach? It's for the greater good, and the greater good is way bigger than sports or anything else will ever be. So you know what? I'm okay with sitting out right now and with not having sports. I mean, I'm a little bored at the moment with no sports. But honestly, Coach, I think we all are. You know, but end of the day, Coach, you're absolutely right. It's for the greater good, and whenever we get back to sports is whenever we get back to sports, right?
Yeah, and I think not that we don't appreciate what we do, whether it's go to work or picking up your children from school. The fact that that's all been taken away from us at the moment, I think we'll all have a appreciation for the freedom and movement we have once this virus passes.
Absolutely, Coach. So, okay, so we got a couple questions for you, because once again, I don't want to keep you forever today. You're a busy man, even with this whole virus and everything going around. You're a busy man. You're the head coach of a major, major program at UCR, and I'm just, like I said, I'm so happy to have you here today. So let's go ahead and get into these questions. So, I guess we get into first things first. Just your second year. So in your second year of being head coach of UCR men's basketball, what would you say is something that clicked within your team this year to improve as much as you did? Was it before or during the season?
Look, I think it was before the season. You know, I think in any college program, you really make steps in the summer, in the spring and summer, and preseason. And then once you get in the season, it's very hard to just keep improving unless, you know, because you don't have as much practice time. So I thought we made a big jump in the summer in terms of our mental and physical toughness. I thought our conditioning got better in year two, because it's hard to change everything in year one. And then our talent level got better, you know, until you put those three things together. It allows you to at least put a better product on the floor or court once you put those three things together.
And you know, Grant's coach, and I'll tell you, I really do. I love that, because the gelling, as we always say, you know, the real coming together, the real mending as a team, the real everything, you know, the getting stronger, the getting better. That all happens in the off season, and in the regular season, special things could happen as well. But that's the finished product out there on the court. So I definitely can see how you guys got better during the off season, and it happened before the season. So that leads me to this next question, which I'll tell you what, Coach, you blew my mind from about 1500 miles away, because this was insane, and we were so excited. Of course, color commentator Jeffrey Gorham, a real good friend of mine, actually how I got in contact with you, he told me all about it when it happened. I mean, he was texting me, and we were talking about it, of course, and it was just such an exciting thing. I mean, we were all following this, and it was incredible. So, as stated in the previous question, The team drastically improved from last year, tying the most wins in a single season for UCR as a D1 program. The season began with a huge win over Nebraska on the road. What was it like coaching that game? What was the team like throughout the game, especially at the half when you guys were up by 4 points? And what was the second half like when you guys came out and literally dominated that second half? Would you say that this was the momentum changer, or in this case, the momentum giver, since it was the first game of the season? Or was there another game this season that you felt gave you guys the momentum to reach the 17 victories that you guys did?
Well, that's a great question, Larry. You know, I think, you know, we played in the preseason and we played some close scrimmages where we won and beat some good teams. I can't identify who they are, but we won our preseason games that were close scrimmages. And then we went into Nebraska. You know, Fred Hoiberg is a great coach, obviously, when you look at his record as an NBA coach and former college coach at Iowa State. But, you know, they're a Big Ten team, but they're a new team, you know. And my message to them going into the game was, the teams we played in the preseason are just as good as Nebraska, and we did well against them and beat them. So don't worry about the fans in the gym. Don't worry about the name on the chest. Just go out and do what we do for 40 minutes. Let's see where this game, ball game, lies. You know, at that time, you look up and you're up 4 points. And we hadn't played perfect at halftime by any sense. It wasn't like we were shooting lights out or playing mistake-free basketball. And so I just approached them at halftime about where we need to improve, you know, and improving those areas in the second half. And what about 4 months to go? I looked up at the scoreboard and we're up 20 at Nebraska, and I had to pitch myself and you know, really soak in that we're up 20 at Nebraska without thinking we were going to lose, you know, and keep momentum. And so I think, you know, obviously when you won that game as a new coach and a new program, the biggest thing you get is buy-in. You know, anytime, because then I could solidify why we had a hard preseason, why the summer was hard, why we do what we do, because we would beat Nebraska on day one, you know. And so anytime we had slippage during the year, I could always bring it back to the Nebraska game, because the buying was there. And, you know, we're not playing Big Ten teams on a daily basis throughout the year. And so I could always keep that bar high for this group throughout this second year.
Coach, I just got to give you the applause button for that one. I mean, that is incredible, beautifully said. And I'll tell you, that was just... I love how you put that. I love how you put it. You know, halftime. Don't let the moment be bigger than the game itself. And I love how you said to your players that it's not... Don't worry about it. Don't worry about the name, the gym. You're right, absolutely. The name on the chest of the players, the gym that you're playing in, and the fans, absolutely. And then telling you, yeah, at halftime, you guys are doing so good. And I was like, yes. And then you're absolutely right when it comes to the end of the game, because I didn't even realize that you guys were up by so much. All I saw was great UCR basketball. And before you knew it, the game was getting real close to the end, and there was no way the Highlanders were going to lose this thing. So I just thought it was incredible, Coach, and you had a very great the team that day, the morale, everything was just, it just worked, and it was awesome. So with that, let's get into the next question here. What players would you say made the most growth this season?
Look, I thought, you know, start with our local product and Dominic Pickett, you know, him being from Moreno Valley and being a junior for our program. You know, when I took over the program, he's still a walk-on, but he was a former manager that did a walk-on that now became our starter and captain. But I thought his growth throughout the year as a player, obviously he started every game for us. I think he finished top 50 in the country, shoot three. But his leadership grew throughout the year. So I thought he made a huge jump for us in that program in getting us in the right direction and staying consistent. I also thought Callum McCray made a jump for us. He didn't start just at the initiation of the year. But as of late, probably the last 15 games of the year, he was arguably, you know, top three center in the Big West. And so he made a huge jump going into his sophomore year. And then lastly, Arinze Chittum, who was a Washington State transfer, he didn't play in that game in Nebraska because he was ineligible because of transfer rules. But you know, I thought by the end of the year, he was probably a first or second team Big West Conference guy because he worked all year. And so those three were key pieces for us, and their improvement throughout the year helped us to continue to move the needle as we continue to drink it in the Big West.
I love it, Coach. I mean, really, right now, I got to tell you, Dominic Pickett, yes, I mean, a walk-on, and he has just, he runs point, and I love watching him play. He does exactly what he used to do at Rancho Verde. You know, I remember seeing him a little bit a couple years back, and he is absolutely the, you know, like the manager, if you will. He's out there. He's doing everything he can to help out. And Chittum, absolutely. I mean, you can't say enough about this guy. Washington State transfer, somebody who I believe is just, the sky is the limit for that young man. You can tell how hard he works. I mean, Coach, I've never seen you guys practice, but I can tell you right now, just from seeing him on the court, I can tell that he's somebody who just, I don't care if it's practice or whatever it is, he's playing a pickup game in the streets. He's going as hard as he can. So it just seems like that. And then, of course, McCray, somebody. Yeah, I mean, this was insane seeing him play this year because, of course, we have, you know, international players a lot in basketball, and seeing him play out of New Zealand, he has just done such a remarkable job this year. So the best part about that, Coach, is all three of those young men are coming back for you next year. How are you feeling about that?
Yeah, it makes you light. Maybe it makes you sleep a little better at night, you know, knowing that they're coming back. And the main thing about when you build a program, you need your returns. You know, you can do it with one and done guys or quick fixes with transfers, but I think for your program to last for a long time, you need stability and guys that are coming back in year three and year four into your program. So it's a luxury to have. With the addition of the other guys that played so many minutes for us, what else have come in as freshmen? I think the program and the team head in the right direction come 2020-2021 season.
I completely agree, Coach. I think you guys have this team next year is going to be incredible, and I cannot wait. I will have a front row seat. I am so excited to sit there and watch you guys play. So moving forward, with season coming to an abrupt end due to the COVID-19 virus, what was your message for your team after the NCAA decided to cancel the remainder of the season, especially with just one game left on the schedule?
Look, that was a tough message, because when I got word from my fantastic athletic director, Tamika Smith-Jones, I got word about 9:30 that the Big West tournament was going to get shut down. Well, we had walked through at 9 a.m. in the hotel getting ready to prepare for the barber. And, you know, we really thought with this group that we could win a couple games in the Big West tournament. If we got to the third, anything could happen. And we took some losses towards the end of the year, you know, some one-point losses that we shouldn't have really lost. So it could have gone either way, put it that way. But I've really tried our team improve throughout the course of the year, and that's not always the case in college basketball. Sometimes there's slippage at the end of the year. I thought we were going the other direction. We were playing better, and our group was playing better together. But all that being said, when that message came through, it was a good teaching point for this group of young men. You know, basically to tell them the chips every day. And as a coach, when you say, tomorrow's not promised on the basketball floor, this is a true rendition of it, you know, to sit there in front of them and talk to them about, you know, cherishing every moment on the floor, and that the game can be taken away from the snap of a finger, and obviously proving that they. The toughest part for me, though, Larry, was telling those two seniors, in the Kimbe Martin and the girls, that the career was over. That's the hardest part, because they don't have a chance to come back to college and finish up what they started. And that goes for all seniors around the country. You know, I think when you figure out your last game in college is over, it's a tough feeling. And, you know, if you're lucky enough to go play professionally, that's one thing. But your days with your teammates in college can't be taken back. And so that was probably the hardest part on that afternoon, on that morning.
Coach, that is a... That is exactly what I thought you may have said, something around there, because I'll tell you, that's I think that's any coach in that situation that would have to say, well, that's it. And especially for those seniors, true. I mean, the two seniors, that is so tough to even hear. And absolutely, the Kenby Martin, remember, he is actually out of Riverside. He plays for all of you listening. The Kenby Martin is actually a Riverside product as well, playing out of J-Dub North. So, yes, I'll tell you right now, Coach, it was definitely a rough moment for the entire sports world, but I couldn't even imagine how it felt to have to tell your seniors that was the end of the line for them. So you're absolutely right. When it comes to professional ball, hey, that's awesome. And, you know, hopefully you can go overseas or somewhere, even get a shot at the NBA if that's a possibility, or the G League. But yeah, there's nothing quite like college ball, and, you know, a very tough moment for you, I'm sure. But I believe, you know, you handled that extremely well. And what more could you say? So I really thought you guys would make a nice deep run in the Big West tournament, and I'm always pulling for UCR, man. I'm telling you guys did a great job this year. So with that said, let's see here. We can finish this up pretty quick here, Coach, because I don't want to keep you forever. But so going over that, looking right now over your entire season, what would you say was the most memorable game for you? I mean, I know Nebraska was pretty darn big, but what other game, or maybe just Nebraska, what game do you feel was just one of the most memorable games you can think of this season, or you may have several?
Yeah. Look, I thought our game at Fresno State was big for this group. And we talked about being the toughest team, the most resilient team, and the most competitive team this year. And I said in the country, not in the Big West, but in the country. And that doesn't take skill to do that. That's heart and determination and having no quit. And so that was our approach every day in practice and every day in games. And so we're at Fresno just after Christmas. We're down 21 points in the second half after coming back from Christmas break, and we come back and win the game by 4. And to be on the road and be down 21 against a Mountain West opponent, against a good friend and good team in Fresno State, really show the toughness and the resilience of this group. Because some teams, when you're down 20, can go to 30 or 40, and you can quit, but this group didn't. And so I think, You put that with the Nebraska win, it got us in place to be in every single game within the Big West. There was not one game we weren't up all year, and that game at Fresno, I think, really got us going in the right direction heading the Big West.
I completely agree, Coach. That, ladies and gentlemen, by the way, Fresno State, that game was remarkable. And yeah, Coach says, down here, the Highlanders were down 30-21 at the half, and then to come back and win this thing 60-57, talk about a big night for Chittum, the forward from UCR. 23 points, he went 9-for-13 from the field, and I mean, just talk about a big day there. How big was that game for him? I mean, would you feel that he really kicked into overdrive, or do you feel that regardless, it was still a big team effort? What would you say about that, Coach?
Yeah, I think it was a huge team effort, but he kicked it into overdrive, and it's part of why he played in the Pac-12. You know, his first two games with us, you know, he's kind of feeling himself out because, like I said, transfer had to sit out the first half of the year, and so I think for him and us, he played big on the stage like I expect him to, and it kind of put him where he was in our team, and he became a starter from there on out because of those numbers. But definitely solidified where he was within that hierarchy of the team. And he was big for us that day. Kenby Martin came on, was big for us in the second half. A huge shot to get us the victory. And so I thought there again that game against Fresno State really got our season going in the right direction heading into Big West play.
Absolutely, Coach. I can see that so much right there, and I love it. I love the fact that you guys played so darn well, especially right there after Christmas break, a time that's usually, you know, kind of tough time sometimes for athletes, but your guys adapted so well. And last but not least, final question of the day, Coach. With nearly your entire team coming back next season, how optimistic are you that next year can be the year where the Highlanders not only make a deep run in the Big West tournament, but
can possibly win the most games in program history at the D1 level. And I don't know, Coach, you guys make a deep enough run, you might win that thing next year in the Big West. I'm just saying, I know I'm not trying to get too crazy here. I'm trying to not look too far ahead. But basically, overall, I just want to ask, with your whole team coming back next year, I know you say you're already excited. How optimistic are you that you're going to have a even better season than this year and make things happen?
Look, I think, you know, we have a chance to, I think, compete for being the top three before in the league, which probably hasn't always been said here as of late. And if you finish in the top three, anything can happen. You know, I think Coach Turner and Irvine are still probably the team to beat. And then it's pretty even after that, you know. And like you said, we have three starters coming back, which always helps, and three starters that have played a lot of minutes and put in a lot of points for us. And so that helps when your program's heading in the direction we are heading in. You know, I'm a little disappointed. I don't know if you know this, but we were invited to the CIT and CBI, which are two postseason tournaments, which has never been done here before either. So that tournament experience would have helped us, regardless whether we won the Big West or not. Postseason play was in store for this group. And so that environment would have helped us, you know, getting ready for this year, just on what postseason basketball is about. But I do think with the pieces we have in place, with the pieces we have coming in, that we can make a run for the regular season title and then hopefully get a good seat in the Big West. And like you said, anything can happen, and you can be playing later in March here at UC Riverside.
Oh, Coach, I'm telling you, I am so excited for this team next year, and I completely agree that this team, anything could happen. That I am so bummed out to hear that you had a chance playing a postseason tournament, and that's never been done in UCR history. That is a bummer, and I am crushed at the fact that you guys wouldn't be able to participate in that, or any team participate in anything, of course, because of the coronavirus and all this going on. But regardless, you guys played an incredible season. I am beyond pumped up to be there next year and to see you guys playing, and it is just a very great atmosphere. And Coach, what you have brought to this team, like, you're a humble guy, you're a very humble, very, very humble person, but I just gotta tell you, what you have brought to UCR basketball has just been incredible, and I haven't ever seen this team this good, this strong, this tough ever since I've been following UCR basketball. So I just want to thank you for that, and honestly, I'm looking forward to you next year. So with that said, Coach, any last comments before you're up out here for the day?
No, I want to thank you for having me on your show. And like I said to all the listeners, like, the health is the most important thing for all of us, and taking care of your neighbor at this point in time. And we're sorry we couldn't continue to represent Riverside during the season, but like we all know, the ball's not important as our health. And so we'll be back bigger and better next season. And I can't thank all of you enough for following UCR basketball, UCR athletics, and you following my program there.
Well, Coach, I'll tell you, we got a bunch of people in the chat room right now, and they certainly appreciate you stopping by. And, hey, at the end of the day, go Highlanders. So, once again, Coach, thank you so much for stopping by today and spending some time with us here. Couldn't appreciate you more, and I look forward to having you back on the show very soon.
Thanks so much, Larry. And like you said, go Highlanders.
Yes, sir. Take care. God bless. Talk to you soon. Yeah. All right, y'all. Ladies and gentlemen, once again, Coach David Patrick. That's right. He's the man. Is he not the man? I mean, come on now. I'm so glad that we could talk to him again. He's a very humble man, and he knows his thing. He does his thing. He's such a great coach. You should see him, y'all. When you see him in action, you see him. Like, you see him out there. Yeah, he's a coach. Yeah, he gets crazy with his players when he has to. Like, you know, when it comes to on the court stuff. But I'll tell you what, he's a very, you gotta see him coach in person to see him, to really get, like, everything I'm trying to say, because my words do him no justice. He's a great guy. As you hear, he's a humble man, and he's just here to continue to deliver his best to this UCR program. Let me just go ahead and give you this real quick, courtesy of Wikipedia. That's right, I wiki this. But since D1, okay, since UCR has been D1 in 2001, okay, their best season to date was in 2008-2009 under Jim Woolridge, before the previous coach. He was here two coaches ago, basically, and they went 17-13 that year. They tied for fourth in the Big West, and that was it. Well, after that, they wouldn't have another season concluding in 17 wins until this year, where they went 17-15. So yeah, there was two less games played. Regardless, I just gotta say, I haven't even looked at that season, but I think this is probably the best, in my opinion, best season for UCR Riverside. Because come on, y'all, Coach talked about that Fresno State victory. Coach also, we talked about that big Nebraska victory to kick things off. Those are big victories, guys. The local talent is here. It's just, there's so much that goes into this. Of course, international talent as well, but there's so much that goes into this. And Coach David Patrick has done something remarkable at a place that hasn't been remarkable. They haven't had very many good seasons. And, you know, though I am a big-time CBU fan, of course, CBU alum, CBU current student in grad school, I love my CBU Lancers. I'm going to do my best to try and get Coach Croy here on the show pretty soon here, the head coach of CBU. But still, I am a fan of both of these schools. This is the Crosstown Showdown. Lots and lots and lots of battling between these two teams all season long and just, you know, in all sports. And I love it. I love this rivalry. It is what the city of Riverside needed, the county of Riverside. It is what the county of Riverside needed. And if you haven't checked it out yet, y'all, I mean, yeah, the original, if you will, Crosstown rivalry, at least in Southern California, is always going to be UCLA and USC, but you know what? A little bit on the lower scale, and hopefully soon to be on the higher scale, UCR, UC Riverside, of course, and CBU, Cal Baptist University, two schools now who are really doing their thing in D1. CBU is just their second year in. I want to jump to the chat room real quick because I have something to kind of tie in real fast, okay? And Jonathan, of course, Couch Crew Chief, I love what he said. That, you know, when Coach talked about the transfer rule a few minutes ago, Coach, he says, stupid transfer rules. If a college wants to buy a player, they should be able to. And I couldn't agree more, Jonathan. The reason why is because of crap like that, when you can't play certain parts of the season, you can't play here, can't play though, you have to sit out a year, it ruins eligibility. It ruins a lot. I mean, I don't know if it 100% ruins the eligibility, but it's just really annoying. That is a dumb rule. I've never had to go through it myself, but it is a very dumb rule. And speaking of dumb rules in the NCAA, a dumb rule is the stupid probation rule. Like, seriously, look, I get it when you jump up from one division to another, or, you know, jump up from one division to a higher division, there's a probation period, but why does it have to be 4 years? That is the stupidest rule, and I am so bummed out about that, because the two seasons are down, and we have two to go at CBU. But yeah, for four full seasons, none of our programs, even though we are D1, can compete in any major postseason tournaments or anything. So basically, that's pretty much it. Nothing doing. We were going to play, believe it or not, well, actually, CBU had a very good year this year. I'm very excited, which is, I'm so super excited to hopefully try and get Coach Croy on here as well, because CBU did something remarkable this year, y'all. Best season. So, but I think both these teams, and they played each other this year, my gosh. The Crosstown Showdown, CBU and UCR this year, the second annual, if you will, Crosstown Showdown, was incredible this year. It was a great game. The atmosphere was huge. The seats were packed. I mean, I don't know if it was full to capacity, but everybody, I mean, a lot of people were there. It was awesome. But I gotta tell you, this year, CBU did something remarkable, finishing second in the WAC, okay, at 10-6 in the WAC, and at 21-10. This team had never won past that. They've never won over 17 games. This year, hearing Coach Croy in an interview, he said that they would have to win, or that their goal was 17 this year to beat better than 17. Well, guess what? They freaking won, okay? They won 21, okay? And they didn't win the WAC. They wouldn't have won. But you know they would have won the WAC? They wouldn't have been able to compete in the WAC tournament, which is absolute crap, okay? And on top of that, it's like, wow. I mean, the small school thing really irritates me, because I don't like that, okay, you have to either win Big West or the WAC to get in. I feel like even if you're the runner-up in your tournament, you should still be able to get in the tournament and chop out these. I know they're ranked, but seriously, you can you know, Duke or North Carolina, yeah, they're still ranked high, but they lost in the quarterfinals of their tournament. But oh, just because they're so high up there, they still get in. I get it, they're ranked, but to the teams that still get in, even if they're not ranked, like, I don't know if that's even a thing. Okay, but still, that just irritates me because these teams got to work so hard. And it's like, you got to win it all or go. That's it. So I don't know. I get it. The bigger school thing, the Power Five conferences, I get that. But it's just really annoying with that. But going back to that stupid rule is stupid. Okay? Seriously, I am so irritated that I know this year the coronavirus stopped everybody. But to think that even if CBU would have won the WAC this year, we would have not have gotten in. That is the dumbest thing. I mean, seriously, that was the stupidest. I cannot stand that rule. It is beyond irritating, and I just really don't understand why it has to be 4 years. I'll tell you right now, I thought for sure that we were going to be able to, you know, at least have a 2 year period. I didn't know it was 4 years, okay? But that is the dumbest thing ever, to have the 4 years thing. And so it kind of sucks. It sucks for recruiting because it's like, well, yeah, how are you going to tell a freshman 1 year after their first year in D1? Oh, yeah, well, so you know, you can't play, you can't participate in any postseason, like major postseason, you know, tournaments or anything, and you can't compete for a national title until you're a senior. Like, that's even for somebody that's 2 years after, like right now, Coach Croy and CBU have to be telling kids, well, you're not going to be able to compete for a title for your first 2 years, but you can compete for a title when you're in your junior and senior year. I mean, the more years, the better, of course. I mean, but still, that's really annoying that, and I mean, the more years, the better for your team, like, I'm sorry, for, like, the further you go, meaning, like, if, you know, 1 year, 2 year, 3 years, so if in your final year probation, well, then you gotta, you know, you can tell your guys, well, guess what, next year we can compete for a title, or, you know what, play for us 1 year, it's your freshman year, but you get 3 years to compete for a title. Still, it's just really annoying, so I just can't stand that. So let's get to the chat room real quick, because this is a big matter, and let's take a look here and see what everyone says. So, alright, so Jonathan says here, let's see, actually, let's see, let's go right here. So Taryn says, so that's why women's volleyball team was my, oh yeah, exactly, yes, Taryn, the probationary period, yes. So Taryn says, so that's why the women's volleyball team was in the WAC, or wasn't in the WAC tournament this year, and yeah, it's probation, so that's really dumb, very, very, very stupid, but that's the reason why. And then Jonathan says here, probation rule is idiocy, and it is. The whole point of moving up to D1 is to be able to play in the big shows. And I love this. It's so true. Finance the sports teams, finance the college, and that's absolutely right. And he says, it's just punishment for wanting to be good, and it really is. And, okay, I can get, like, if it's one or two, okay, I get it. Okay? I understand that 1 or 2 years, okay? I understand that. You know what? Because this is their excuse. This is from what I heard. We're going to give you guys like 1 or 2 years, okay, to get better and to see if you can compete at this level. If you can, then good. If you can't, then we're going to keep you at D2, you know, in a sense. Like, I guess that's kind of the rule. I guess that's from what I'm at least guessing why this probationary period is. Why does it have to be 4 years? Right now, CBU is like, yeah, we're good. We can compete. This is 2 years. Last year, we won 17 games, I think was the most, and we were good. And then this year, we won 21. Yeah, second place in the WAC. I think we can compete at the D1 level. I'm just really concerned. Well, I'm not concerned. I'm really ticked off and irritated the fact that we couldn't compete. So it's annoying, but at the same exact time, rules are rules, and I get it. So Jonathan also says here, let's see what he says, yeah. You know why Duke and Kentucky are ranked high? Because they've always been ranked high. And they have. And it's true, okay? They've always been ranked. And they will continue to be ranked. Those are top programs. I mean, you got Coach Calipari. You got Coach K, of course. Krzyzewski. I mean, you have all of these players, okay? I mean, these big-time coaches. I get that. But I guess, I don't know, it annoys me that at least the runner-up couldn't get in, and somebody else can be denied, even if they're ranked. I'm just saying. So, I'm a Bama fan, and I can honestly say that they are ranked high year after year because they are. That's it. They just are. And you know what? I guess that's exactly it. Because you are who you are. It's one of those things, you know? And I guess that's just the way it's going to be. Which I understand, but it's just irritating when the lower schools just don't have that chance, you know? How crazy is it that those Cinderella stories can't be of a team who didn't win their tournament, kind of like UNBC a couple years ago? How come, you know, those Cinderella stories can't be like a runner-up like CBU who didn't even win their tournament but made a deep run in Marks Bandits anyway? I would love to see that. But then again, oh, competition. Yeah, I get it, but you never know. That's why I would love a tournament in FBS like FCS. But that's a talk for another day. So anyway, Darren says here, the probation rule is really garbage. 4 years without a postseason, terrible. And yes, Taryn, I could not agree more, okay? So, yeah, I'm a big SC guy, but if USC doesn't deserve to get there and we're ranked, like, 20-something or, like, lower, and we lost in the quarterfinal, then you know what? Maybe a school like CBU should get in over you. You didn't even win your freaking conference tournament. You were eliminated in the first round. You know what I mean? Like, I'm just saying. So, I don't know. The ranking, I get it, but is what it is. And that's my own team. I know it's because of CBU. I'm all over it right now. But there we go. So, anyway, y'all, with that said, that is that for the first segment here of the show. Hopefully you enjoyed this interview with Coach David Patrick of UCR, and I am so excited that I was able to talk to him. Great person, and I hope you all became UCR fans right now because of him. He is a great guy, and look forward to another great season next season. So, with that said, y'all, we're going to take ourselves a quick break, and when we get back, we're going to jump on in to a little bit of NFL free agency. Oh, yes. I'm going to have some fun with my new segments, Are You Trippin'? And I see you. And, of course, we're going to be closing out the day with Bring It Home. So be ready for it, y'all. New segments here on The Defining Moment. New stuff here. All kinds of new crap, y'all. It's kind of like when you were a kid and you got taken to Toys R Us. Rest in peace, Toys R Us. It was like when you were a kid and you get taken into Toys R Us and you smell that new plastic smell, like that new smell, like everything's new, like that new smell, or, you know, nostalgia, or a new car smell. That's always a nice smell, right? It's kind of like that right now with this show. It's got a little bit of a new look to it. So let's have some fun with y'all. When we get back, let's get on in to some NFL free agency. Oh, yeah. We'll see you on the other side of this break. Once again, you're listening to The Defining Moment right here on IE Sports Radio, your direct feed for all that is sports.
Hey, all my NBA college basketball fans out there. Tired hearing about just the dramatic stuff in the basketball world. Tired hearing about what such and such reward tonight. And not about the game? Hey, leave all of that alone. Because on Wednesday night, I got this show called Fast Break with Phil Jones here on the IE Sports Radio. And all we talk about is straight basketball. From where it comes down to the NBA, the NCAA, and even the WNBA. I don't discriminate. I give all my NBA, my basketball, whatever you want with sports, to the slam dunk, to the three-pointers, to the teardrops, to the game winners. I'm there. I'm speaking about it. I have a debate. I have my panel. I got a squad that rolls in, and we're going to be talking mad sports. We're going to be talking about the Lakers. We're going to be talking about even the Brooklyn Nets. We're going to be talking about who's the top team out there in the NBA. So, tie all the drama. Tie all the... What did he wear today? What kind of shoes he had? Get all that. Just come over. Fast Break Phil Jones here on IE Sports Radio every Wednesday night at 8 Eastern, 5 p.m. Pacific time, y'all. So, yo, tune in.
Were you listening to a great game on USRN, but then the Wi-Fi crashed in the final seconds? Or do you simply want to listen to the best calls we here at USRN have to offer? Well then, you need to go check out our Audio Boom page. It holds a collection of our best calls that you don't want to miss. How do I get there, you ask? You can download the Audio Boom app and look up Ultimate Sports Radio, or simply go to audiobook.com/Ultimate Sports Radio. And as always, thanks for listening and making USRN one of the most talked about sports networks on Mixler.com.
Show with your host Gabriel Montoya. This is the show for soccer, football fans, or whatever you call the beautiful game. Every week I tackle the latest and greatest news from around the soccer world, from the English Premier League to the World Cup to MLS, Liga MX, and more. You can listen to the Soccer Scoreboard Show and our lineup of fantastic guests every Friday at noon here on IE Sports Radio, your direct feed for all that is sports.
Attention all sports fans! If you're someone who wakes up each morning with a list of sporting events to go along with your to-do list for the day, then you just might be a diehard. The world of sports is as vast as the ocean is deep, including the major leagues, the minor leagues, the colleagues, and everything in between. This is Mia Barlera of IE Sports Radio, welcoming you to join me every Monday evening at 4 p.m. Pacific, 7 p.m. Eastern on The Defining Moment, a show that focuses on what really matters in the sports world, sports themselves, and nothing outside of them. Once again, tune in for The Defining Moment with Mia Boyle-Larrabee every Monday evening at 4 p.m. Pacific, 7 p.m. Eastern on IE Sports Radio, right here on Spreaker.com. We'll see you there.
That is right! It may not be a Monday, and it may not be 4 o'clock Pacific time, but it is definitely, a Wednesday, and it's definitely time to talk some sports here on The Defining Moment. So with that said, y'all, I just gotta say real quick, I'm gonna let these cats tell you, I'm gonna let them tell you what's up, and announce all that in a little bit. We're gonna be we'll be announcing it when these things happen, and when the deal closes and all that good stuff. Not just deals, but, you know, when all that comes to the top. Regardless, I just gotta say, man, big shout-out to Kyle Crew Chief, man, and, of course, Daryl Kinsey Jr. and Caitlin C., and they're putting together some awesome stuff for you listeners out there in the coming weeks. So, once again, I'm not gonna say anything, just know that we have some big names and some awesome stuff coming your way, all of you motorsports fans. So the rest of us gotta step it up, man, because they are really doing some great stuff, and I could not give a bigger shout-out and a thank you to, of course, Jonathan Couch Crew Chief, man. Great stuff, man. Thank you so much for all you're doing for us. He, of course, has joined the IE Sports Radio family as a big part of our PR department this last couple of months, and he has done an incredible job. So I just want to thank you so much once again for joining us, man. And thank you to the chat room right now listening. And by the way, Terrence says in the chat room before we exited, this is, how can I be a UC Riverside fan if I'm a Long Beach State fan? And you know what? You got a point there, Terrence. You got a point. But that's true, LOL, because he's very correct. It's just one of those things. It's the same conference. If it wasn't the same conference, maybe you could have a little bit of love for him. But yeah, same conference, kind of rough. So I completely understand, Darren. I get you, brother. But yeah. Freaking Jonathan, man, is doing his thing. And yeah, man. So he's all over the place. Like he's like our, I don't even know what to go. Yeah, he says here in the chat room, PR. Yeah, I guess is what this is. I don't know what the hell. What to even give his title at the moment of what he's actually doing for us, but yeah, it's a pretty damn good title. That's all I gotta say. Great stuff there, man, and thank you so much for doing all you do for us, man. So, and of course, thank you to all the entire iSports Radio family for doing what y'all do, man. Y'all are awesome, and I'm couldn't be more blessed. I always say, I'm gonna be more blessed with a better team, y'all. And as I always say, each and every show, y'all, big ups to the man above. Y'all know how it is, y'all. Big ups to the man above, our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, for without him, nothing is possible. That's right. That's right. And I'll tell you, we have always a thing of beauty when we have another beautiful day given to us by our amazing God. So, as always, got to say two big shout out to all you listeners out there who make this thing happen. We appreciate you, listeners. Because without you, we wouldn't be nothing. We would suck. We wouldn't have nobody to talk to. No audience to deliver this to. None of that. So, we want to thank y'all. And we appreciate you so much for listening. And listen to me, yep. And listen to all of my awesome colleagues doing their thing as well. So, anyway, yeah, I just want to let you guys know real quick, too, about CBU. They were actually invited to the CBI, the College Basketball Invitational. Of course, we don't get to play that. That would have been 3 days ago. We were supposed to play on the 15th of March. I think it was the day, or one of those days. But regardless, or maybe the 17th. Maybe that would have been yesterday. But regardless, yeah, well, we didn't get to play in that. And I forgot what tournament Coach Patrick said that they got invited to for UCR, but that's right. They also got invited to a tournament, which really sucks. They couldn't compete in that. I don't know if it was a CBI. I forgot which one it was, he said. But, yeah, it is just annoying. But, once again, y'all, everything's stopping for the greater good at the moment, so that's okay. So, alrighty. So, next up, let's go ahead and get on some NFL free agency. Because within the last 48 hours, the door's been blowing off the NFL. I mean, seriously. Like, this is ridiculous. Everything we have seen in the last 2 days has been absolutely freaking nuts. So nuts that my beloved Oakland... Oh, did I say that? I caught myself! Yay. My beloved and terrible, but I love them. Vegas Raiders just picked up corner Eli Apple. I gotta give a hand clap for that one. Thank you, Mayock and Gruden. We've got a corner. Hey, yeah, we had a secondary last year that was basically the game plan for every team would just be to throw the ball up, and that's, you know, that's pretty much it. And they'd have to do much more, unfortunately. But now I think we may have a little bit of a little something now. So I like it. So let's go team by team real quick, y'all, and just talk about it. This is courtesy here of NFL.com. I'm getting my sources from. This is the tracker here. So let's take a quick look here and talk about all these crazy deals. It was updated at 12:48 p.m. Pacific time. So literally, to the moment, 30 minutes ago. So here we go. Let's talk about it, shall we? So, all right. So team by team. Team. This is alphabetical order. Arizona. Did they get any better? Oh, yes, they did. I love this. This is great, y'all, because you know what? They have some pool now. DeAndre Hopkins, of course, headed on over to the Arizona Cardinals for David Johnson, which really, the Texans got a lot better. They got so much freaking better because David Johnson is a great running back. I know he only had like 1 or 2 years where he was extremely dominant, but gosh dang it, you cannot tell me for one moment in time that this guy can't go over there and make something happen. He's a good player. He's a good athlete. Yeah, things happen, okay? But it is what it is. Honestly, I think sometimes, and as this goes, y'all, you're going to hear me say this a few different times today, sometimes a change of scenery is all you need, and I love this. I freaking love this, okay? I do. I really, really love that David Johnson is heading on over to the Texans, because put him together now with Watkins, and, well, there's some more moves over there in Houston going down, man. Randall Cobb, that was a big move. I just really think that the Texans, the defense is already good. They're going to be awesome. So this is going to be a great day. It is going to be a great day. And, I'm sorry, a great season, I think. And I'm really looking forward to what we got going on right now. It's going to be a great season for the Texans. I really do think this team has the pieces they need right now, and they're moving forward. Like, really, I'm so excited for them. But for the Cardinals, Larry Fitzgerald resigns again because he's awesome, and this guy's going to play until God tells him not to. I'll tell you, he is doing his thing, and I am so blessed that he is working so hard. We're so blessed, okay, to watch this man continue to play year after year at the level he is playing at. So I am so excited to see him play another year. And now he's got help. Now he's got DeAndre Hopkins on the other side. This is going to be awesome. Okay, this is going to be awesome. So anyway, so good stuff there. Also, Jordan Phillips signing, okay, with the Cardinals on a three-year contract. So good stuff there. Okay, now let's get on over. Oh, maybe I should elaborate a little bit more on that. I know, my apologies. But yeah, I should elaborate just a little bit on that. Jordan Phillips, of course, coming, he's a gosh damn monster coming over from the Bills. Amazingly good player out of Oklahoma, sixth year man, and he has plenty left in the tank. I am so excited to see him ball out for the Arizona Cardinals next year, and especially I think they're still in that 34. And if they're playing that 34 defense, perfect, man. He can play in that nose guard position, or maybe even one of the ends. So I really do like how he would fit in this program, or if he would fit in this defense, and I really do think that he's going to make a difference. And I think all these players together, now they got Kyler Murray behind center. Really, the Arizona Cardinals are looking strong. The Atlanta Falcons. What in the world just happened to these guys? They let go of Vic Beasley, but where did Vic Beasley go? To a place that I think he's going to excel at very well, the Tennessee Titans. Mike Vrabel saw a gem in that guy, and he is going to do really well. However, the Falcons would pick up another edge rusher, and I think he's pretty good. I do. I think he's kind of good. Dante Fowler, guys, he is as advertised. We know how good he is. We have seen him, you know, be able to ball. Now, some of you may disagree with that. I still think he has a lot in the tank. I still think he's a damn good player. He's also a sixth-year man. He's out of Florida, and he played a few years. I know he went with the Jaguars at first, and it was a rough go for him, I know. But at the end of the day, I still think that, once again, a change of scenery is a good thing. He could end up being a very big pickup for these Falcons. Also, they will sign Tyler Davidson, defensive tackle. And they'll also sign Hayden Hurst, tight end, which, good stuff there. That was a trade there with the Ravens, and that would be for an exchange of a fifth round, okay, a second and a fifth round pick there with the Ravens. So you know what? Good deal, and I think they got to, you know, they need a tight end. Now that you have freaking Tom Brady, which we already talked about a little bit, and we're going to get into that, you have Tom Brady, and you have Bridgewater with his own team. In this division, yeah, the NFC South is going to be nuts. So they need all the help they can get. And a tight end is kind of a nice thing to have. Okay, so anyway, Baltimore. All right, Michael Brockers. How about this? The LSU man is about as psycho as psycho gets. And I love the fact that I wish he would have won with the Raiders, man. I really do. But he is a gosh damn monster. He's 9 years in and still absolutely disruptive as can be. Let him go on over now to this defensive-ridden place. Baltimore is going to shine. I mean, this defense is... they're just always sickening. Now you have a guy behind center, as we've seen all year long. He is literally the human cheat code, if you will. I mean, what more can you really say? Really, I want to know. What more can you say about the freak of nature monster that is Lamar Jackson? Okay, but, just got some news here. Look at that. Chargers sign corner Chris Harris from the Denver Broncos. That's actually a good pickup. Chris Harris, I know he's got a little age on it, but who cares? He's a good player, so the Chargers just came up right now. I like that. Good pickup for the Chargers, and we could really see something happening in the future for this defense. Right now, it's something. Yeah, I saw Taryn just put it right now in the chat room. As a matter of fact, let me see what he said. Yeah, they just, yeah, they look like, and now they need a quarterback. They do. But Harris is going to be an absolute beast for this team. The Chargers need all the help they can get. So kind of like the Raiders. So good pickup there, but we'll get to them. Anyway, Baltimore looking good. Calais Campbell and Michael Brockers are on the same team. Yeah, the world just exploded. This is going to be awesome. I cannot wait to see these guys get in action here. Amazingly good job here by the Ravens to acquire Calais Campbell from the Jaguars. I got a trade there in exchange for a fifth-round pick, so that is a steal. Amazing job there. And, of course, and this is hilarious because Taryn... it was hilarious. On Let's Wind About Sports on Monday, this was pretty funny. with Mike Pence. Darren put in there, I know I had to have saw this. I watch every freaking game, everybody, but I know those entrances on Sunday Night Football are hilarious. And yes, Matt Judon body by Taco Bell, which was hilarious that Taryn showed me, but that was, yeah, that was pretty funny. But yes, they franchise tagged him, so hey, you need a player like him, okay? So you got Calais Campbell, Michael Brockers, and Matt Judon. Yeah, you kind of have a disruptive front. So I am excited for this, guys. This is going to be big. So also, Matt Skura, the center, they placed the original round tender on him. On the restricted free agent per Garofalo, so that's the source. But yes, so as of right now, I like what the Ravens are doing. Next up, Buffalo. Oh yeah, Buffalo. What can we say about the Bills? Oh, I don't know. Maybe they freaking signed Stephon Diggs. Yeah, how's that? How's that for a pickup? All right. Stephon Diggs is absolutely in his prime right now. This guy is playing great football. He knows what he wants in a program, and apparently the Vikings just weren't it. So too bad, so sad. But I'll tell you right now, the guy's going to go shine in Buffalo. Allen is getting better, okay? His accuracy is getting so much better. The guy is a threat on the ground. Now they went and picked up Vernon Butler, which is freaking awesome. Because, yeah, two-year deal with Vernon Butler. He's a big monster in the middle there, a big tackle from the Saints. I mean, sorry, from the Carolina Panthers. Great player there, okay? Now you have him. They signed Mario Addison, which Addison is also, he is an extremely underrated linebacker, in my opinion, also from the Carolina Panthers. A very, very good job by acquiring him. He's an edge rusher, linebacker type of player. Great player. They also have Quentin Jefferson now from the Seahawks. Yeah! How about this, kid? Yeah, how you like that, Buffalo Bills? And then Josh Norman, okay? They keep him. Yeah, he's still there. Okay, so that's pretty darn big. And then another big keep that they kept here was Quentin Spain, okay? The big boy, the guard. They re-signed him. So, yeah, Buffalo's looking a little scary right now. It might be Halloween, I don't know, but this team is absolutely looking great. I am so excited to watch the Bills next year. The Bills just got that much better. I don't even wait till we get to the Dolphins, all right? I mean, this is great. The AFC East is going to be a little bit different this year, I'll tell you that. So, moving forward to the Carolina Panthers, ladies and gentlemen, it is time for our first new segment of the show, because I just have to do this. I don't even care. Okay? That's all there is to it. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome in here. Our first new segment of this new defining moment era. This set is called Are You Trippin'? Ladies and gentlemen, the Chicago Bears needed everything that they can get, and they got it. They acquired a player by the name of Khalil Mack from the Raiders last year, in case you don't know who that is. Beast. Okay, being sarcastic. They also have Roquan Smith, a player who I thought would be absolutely amazing with the Raiders and have them two on the same defense. Instead, they're both on the Bears, which is like the perfect storm, right? The monsters of the Midway. Well, I'm tweeting all this fun stuff, and guess what? I start seeing tweets about how dumb the decision would be, or how stupid that Nick Foles heading on over to the Chicago Bears would be. Let's rethink this, shall we? Yeah. Are you tripping? Chicago Bears fans, are you tripping? Everybody out there talking about Nick Foles not being a great pickup for the Bears. Are you tripping? Yeah, you're tripping. Because Nick Foles won a freaking Super Bowl, okay, with a team that, honestly, they were good, but yeah, he takes over for the starter,
Of course, we all know who that starter is. I'm not going to bring up any names. But I am going to say, yeah, the Eagles were tripping for not keeping Nick Foles. Nick Foles then goes on over to the Jaguars. Yeah, he didn't have the best season, but guess what? He's still Nick Foles, and he's still pretty damn good. Let him go now over to the Chicago Bears, who has a very good defense, and they're picking up more pieces. Cohen's still running back. They're still playing great. Guess what? They're going to be pretty damn good. All they need was a quarterback. And guess what? Their guy is now there. So, everybody, stop tripping. And that was Are You Trippin'? Because people are tripping. Like, seriously, people are tripping. How do you think Nick Foles going to the Bears is a bad thing? How? Like, I explain that, and I will fight you every step of the way. He's a damn good quarterback. And if he's not, then my bad. But personally, I do think he's a very good player still. And yeah, let him be on a good team. Let him get the perfect storm. Let him get a good defense. Let him be on a team like how he was with the Eagles. And you might just kind of see something. So with that said, y'all, yeah, that was our tripping. Because I think a lot of people are tripping right now. Talking about how, oh, well, Nick Foles wouldn't be. Are you serious? For real, y'all? For real? Yeah, so I think people are tripping at the moment. So that's fine. Let them trip. Whatever. Anyway, so that was our little segment of Are You Tripping? Because we're going to get right on into the Chicago Bears. Okay? This is kind of ridiculous. The Chicago Bears are looking like a good football team again. Nick Foles will be going over to play there from the Jags, doing good. Jimmy Graham just signed a 2-year deal with the Chicago Bears. Yeah, how about that? Robert Quinn, guess what? 5-year contract. And Dan Trevathan was there already, still doing his thing, balling out. You have an amazing defense. You got Jimmy Graham now, and Nick Foles is there. Yeah, Bears fans, get excited. He had a down last year, but this is going to be a... I'm really excited for this. So, next up here, we're going to get into our next segment. And this segment is called, I See You. Why? You're going to find out. So, we're going to start it like this every time. Carolina Panthers! I see you! The Carolina Panthers did something pretty crazy this year. Okay. They did something that I thought was absolutely needed. A change of scenery. But then again, what is a change of scenery? Getting rid of Rivera was really annoying. It really was. But he's off to bigger, better places. Let him do his thing. Cam, well, is what it is. Apparently he's not happy there no more. And guess what? So what? Maybe they're not happy with him? Maybe he's not happy with them? Maybe it's mutual. Good. Cam needs to go somewhere else and ball. However, they have the players, like DJ Moore, and they need to beat that offensive lineup. But guess what? They definitely have a good setup there at the moment. And they may go a little younger, but they want a quarterback a little bit like the quarterback they previously had. Insert Teddy Bridgewater. Oh, yes. Teddy Bridgewater will head on over to the Carolina Panthers to play some football as their starting quarterback. And I think this is a great, great move. In the offseason, they will acquire Russell Okung. Sorry, Taryn, I know your boy. Right there. But before he was your boy, he was Seattle's boy. All right. But I'll tell you, beefing up the offensive line, as I guess mentioned, good job. Then we have Seth Roberts, who is actually a pretty damn good player. He's heading over now to the... he was with the Ravens, and before that he was the Raiders. I know he was good from the Raiders. And guess what? They'll sign him. And then you will get from the Vikings, Stephen Weatherly. 5-year man out of Vanderbilt, who's a pretty damn good defensive end. They re-signed Trey Boston. Okay. And they're looking pretty good at the moment. It says here also Kyle Allen, quarterback, exclusive rights, free agent, signed a one-year deal. So they got their backup. He's a good player. Second-year man out of Houston. I think they're ready to rock and roll. And free agency just barely begun, like, a little bit ago. Okay? Guess what? Carolina Panthers! I see you. I see you. With that said, y'all, let's jump in the chat room real quick and talk to some of our peeps in the chat room. So Terrence says, Nick Foles is a first ballot Hall of Famer. He helped his team win the Super Bowl despite the Eagles not being favored in any of those games. Absolutely, and I couldn't agree more. This man deserves a gold jacket to do what he's done. So great job there. Also, we got some banter going back and forth. I love it. Yes, I know, Marcus. Cam is being forced out, but it is what it is. They want to change the direction. And personally, I think Cam needs to go somewhere else. A change of scenery is always good. And I think Cam can go somewhere else and play great football. You know what? I don't think that's anything bad. And I think he can go somewhere and do his thing. And I'm excited for Cam going somewhere. Maybe he'll go to the Pats. I don't know. But it is what it is. And I think Cam is going to do him. And Cam's still going to be great. He also says, Marcus says here in the chat room, Chargers head coach will be gone next year. The Tyrod move will do him in. Oh, my God. Gosh, and that's right. And by the way, it's funny, this year, yeah, Tyrod Taylor actually told everybody his name was Tyrod, so I'm going to say his name right, but Tyrod, yes, Tyrod Taylor is, that was another move that Taryn talked about a few minutes ago. Well, not a move, but he said that it's looking like Tyrod Taylor or Justin Herbert via the draft will be the guy behind center for the Chargers next year. And Marcus is like, yeah, the Tyrod move will do him in. And that, of course, is Anthony Lynn. And they'll see here. Terrence says, and the Panthers can take Russell Okung. Yes, Trey Turner will definitely help out the Chargers. He will. I think he will. And as for Okung, yeah, he is a little washed up, but you know what? He's still pretty damn good. And let him go somewhere else and at least get another good season. All they need is a good season out of him. And guess what? It's another year for them to, you know, get younger in the draft and find somebody coming out next year. If not, somebody this year they can, you know, put under him and they can learn something. But all I'm saying, you know what? Personally, he can even be that old war horse that goes out there and makes things happen and helps out Teddy. At the end of the day, it's a bunch of pieces, guys, not just one. Football, it's a little bit different than other sports. So, but I see what you guys are saying. And then Taryn, no, Marcus, Anthony Lynn isn't going anywhere. Yes, Marcus Okung is old and injury riddled. So, that's just my thoughts there, because I see you, Carolina. Yeah, I see what you're doing. I see you. I see you guys. And that's what this segment's going to be about every time. I see you. I see you guys doing your thing. I see what's going on. And honestly, I think there's bright days in Carolina. So with DJ Moore still there, and they're going to do big things. So I'm excited for that. So, okay, let's go ahead and skim through the rest of this here. So Cincinnati, this is all once again courtesy of NFL.com under the frequency tracker. I would tell you the exact website, but it's under Google. So, my bad, but okay. So, here we go. We have Cincinnati Bengals right now. AJ Green has franchise tag, because if they lose him, you know, it's that will fall apart at the seams. Plus, they may just be winning I don't know. I'm pretty darn sure they're going to be winning the Joe Burrow sweepstakes, because guess what? They got the first round pick. So, will they get him? We'll see, but it's a big possibility that he will go there. So, they're going to want to keep their number one wide receiver, right? Also, DJ Reader. Expected to sign a four-year deal. And Trey Wayans, I like that. Three-year deal there. Trey Wayans coming over from the Vikings. So, that could be pretty big. And Reader coming on over from the Houston Texans. So, Cleveland Browns, how can they sabotage themselves today? That should be a segment. How can the Browns destroy themselves today? I'm sorry. But yes, the Browns actually did some kind of good. I don't know what's going on now with Baker. This is going to be interesting to see where Baker goes. Will he be a Patriot? because they signed apparently their guy now, Case Keenum from the Redskins. So will he be the guy there now? I don't know. But Baker, oh, where will Baker go? Will Baker be wearing a lightning bolt on the side of his helmet this year? Will he be wearing Pat Patriot or the Flying Elvis or whatever they call him on the side of the helmet? Will he be wearing that? I don't know, but we'll find out. With that said, we have here Jack Conklin agreeing to a 3-year deal. Awesome. Austin Hooper will agree with the Browns, so good pickup there. Also, Kareem Hunt, he will have the second round tender placed on him this year. And Andy Jenovich, fullback, will be they acquired him in a trade from the Broncos, so they got a little bit better there, especially blocking-wise. And, of course, Case Keenum. I don't know what the hell the Browns are doing. I'm going to leave that alone. Yeah, Marcus says shake my head. So, actually, Taryn, I don't know if he's replying to me or Taryn, but Taryn says here, Russell Okung is from Wakanda Tech, according to what he said on Sunday Night Football. And apparently Taryn's going to be doing that all season, which is pretty entertaining. I think that's pretty funny, because those introductions are pretty funny. Ball so hard, university. T-Sizzle, baby, you're saying. But, all right, Cowboys! Probably one of the most, probably one of the best teams in the NFL, talent-wise. And then they get on the field. I'm sorry, Cowboy fans, and I upset you there. Amari Cooper, $100 million deal. Amari Cooper is happy. Okay. He earned it. Now go ball out. That's really all I got to say. I'm not a bitter Raider fan. I think he needed to change scenery. He went over there and he's doing his thing. Now I think he has what he needs. I think he can ball. Blake Jarwin, the tight end, will resign here. Pretty good job there. Sean Lee, I hope he can stay healthy this year. Poor guy. He's a great athlete. Sucks, though. He gets injured, but they re-signed him, so he's re-signed. Gerald McCoy, how about this, y'all? Long time. I remember seeing him get drafted. Long time Buccaneer. Went on over to the Carolina Panthers, and now he's heading on over to the Dallas Cowboys. He signed a 3-year deal. You know what? Good for you, man. The exclusive franchise tag will be placed on Dak Prescott. And you know what? Good. Maybe you should. Because I don't know who else they're going to get. They're too far back in the draft to draft somebody else. The quarterback market right now in the NFL, I mean, unless you want Tom Brady, I mean, or Cam Newton's a big possibility, but those are two older guys. They have exactly who they need behind center, at the moment, at least. So, good. I mean, good. Hold on to what you got. You know, the system. Now that McCarthy's there, I don't know if these are McCarthy's moves, I don't know what's up, but as of right now, okay. And then, Darian Thompson, safety, is expected to resign with the Cowboys. The Denver Broncos! AJ Bouye! How you like that, y'all? He's coming on over from the Jacksonville Jaguars. The Jaguars are just cleaning house right now. They're like, well, let's try this again. The Jaguars are crumbling up papers and throwing them at their trash can right now. That's exactly what... I'm sorry, Jaguars, but that's pretty much it. This is interesting, but... yeah, also, Terry... I'm sorry. Marcus says here, surprise, Winston is floating around out there, and yeah. Winston's going to be finding himself a new home, and where could he go? Could he be wearing a lightning bolt on the side of his helmet next year? Maybe Flying Elvis. I'm just saying. It's a possibility. Anyway, AJ Bouye heading on over to the Broncos from the Jaguars. Good move. Jarrell Casey also going to the freaking Broncos. And he was a beast with the Titans. They acquired him there in a trade. Also, Graham Gaslow. He will sign here. The guard. The big guard there. He's actually a damn good guard. He will be signing with the Broncos as well. Much deserved player. I mean, much deserved... pick up for the Broncos. They do need an offensive line. And last year, I'll tell you right now, the addition of Dalton Risner has been great for them. So just continue to beef up that defensive line, you know. And that's it. Terrence says here in the chat room, that's what I'm saying, Marcus. Where is he going to go? Chargers? What?
Anyway, I heard the Chargers aren't even trying to pursue Tom Brady earlier. I saw it in the tweet, so just saying. Anyway, with that said, let's go ahead and get on to those Detroit Lions, who that should be like the I See You part two. Because seriously, y'all, I see you. You know, as a matter of fact, let's do that. I feel like doing another freaking segment. So, ladies and gentlemen, here is the second I See You for the day. The Detroit Lions, y'all. Matt Patricia is the man with the plan. Last year wasn't the best year for him, but big freaking deal. He just jumped in as a head coach for his first time into a team that he had no control over until, you know, I mean, you develop. I mean, you inherit the team that was there. Guess what? Matt Patricia is good to go, man. He will take not only Jamie Collins from the Patriots, he will also take Duron Harmon. Yeah, that was a trade. That happened. Guess who else didn't go play with their old coach? Danny Shelton. They just did that. Yeah. Matt Patricia was like, hey, y'all come play for me. You remember me? I was your old defensive coordinator. And they're like, yeah, we like you. Let's go. My bad, Bill. But gosh damn it. With that happening, they'll also sign Chase Daniel to sit behind Stafford. I get you. And I don't even want to try and pronounce his first name, but Vitali, offensive tackle here, the big boy. They will sign him from the Eagles. You know what? Detroit Lions, I see you. That's real talk, yo. That's real talk. I see you. Because you know what? There's going to watch. Just watch what they do, guys. Watch. I'm a big fan of Matt Patricia, so... anyway, Marcus says here he might have to accept the backup role, and they're talking about Winston, absolutely. Then he says, Lions are trash. See the Jamie Collins move face pump. Marcus. Everybody is entitled to their own opinion. I'm going to leave that there. Terrence says, I don't think Brady with the Chargers would be a good fit anyway. Basically, it would have been another non-mobile quarterback except with less interceptions. I'm sorry. Did I laugh at that? He did. And yes, Brady to Tampa. LOL. Marcus, I'm going to LOL with you on that. We are going to get there momentarily. So, Packers, Christian Kirksey signs a 2-year deal. Good for you, Christian Kirksey. And also, Rick Wagner, offensive tackle, will sign with the Packers as well. A little bit of help there, not making too many moves. But they got Aaron Rodgers, and for some reason, all they need is Aaron Rodgers. He's like the only player in the NFL who's like, yeah, all you need is me, and I can make the entire team good. So I don't know what he does, but he's just a good leader, guys, and that's really what it is. So the Packers are doing their thing low-key, whatever, and it's awesome. I talked about the Texans earlier. Randall Cobb is just the timeless wonder. Speaking of the Packers, yeah, they had him for a while, and Randall Cobb seems to be the interchangeable piece all over the NFL. This guy can go anywhere and be freaking great. So great job there signing him. They'll resign Kaimi Fairbairn. Good job for the Texans there. Darren Fells will resign with the Texans. Good job. And I said Texans, I'm sorry. Texans. Good job there. Fells, good resigning. They needed him. David Johnson, I told you earlier, I love it. That is a great move. I am sorry. That is a great move. I am so excited to see what this guy can do, man. Also, AJ McCarron will resign with the Texans. They need somebody to sit behind. I'm sorry to feel so blunt, but they need somebody to sit behind Watson, right? And Bradley Roby. This was awesome. Roby is a great player. And you know what? They extend his contract, or they give him a contract. They sign him for 3 years. Great player there. And you know what? They definitely need him on that defensive side of the ball. All right. Now it's time for the Indianapolis Colts. Yeah. Well, I don't know what to say. I really like Jacoby a lot. Jacoby Brissett is a good player to me. Marcus and I had a very interesting debate in our tweets the other day. And you know what? Once again, opinions are their own. I think he's a great athlete. Now, if the Colts want to go in a different direction, that's fine. Where's Jacoby going to go? That's what I want to know. Colts? Guess what? I know you don't like the Patriots, but you might be in business for a trade because now... Who are the Patriots going to start? Stidham? I'm sorry for being so mean to Stidham. He's a good piece. He was decent in college, but I... Give him a chance. Maybe he'll be really good and shut me up. I don't know. But... Bill Belichick was not happy when they let go of Jacoby Brissett. I don't know. Could he be going back to the Patriots? Because now they have freaking Rivers. Yeah, Rivers signs to a one-year deal with the Indianapolis Colts. And the Cazzanzo will re-sign there with a two-year deal, I believe. A two-year deal there. And then, of course, this was the big one that kind of shocked me a little bit, I guess. DeForest Buckner from the San Francisco 49ers will head on over to the Colts. I get it. The Niners have all the depth in the world at the defensive line. But... I don't know. I think the Niners were potent last year because of that defensive line. Yes, I know you have Solomon Thomas back there. I know you have a lot of good players. But DeForest Buckner was a big part of that Niners defense. And you let him go. That hurts. I'm a defensive guy, so I guess I can see it that way. But the Niners have enough depth to where they'll be okay. I just kind of thought that they would keep him. Regardless, though, you know what? Good pickup here. Let's talk about the trade real quick. DeForest Buckner will actually sign, let's see here, the trade was for a first-round pick, which is the 13th overall pick this year for the Niners. The Niners must definitely see something. I mean, they may even go younger. Okay, there's a lot of great athletes coming out in the draft, so I'll tell you, great stuff. I didn't get a chance to cover the freaking free agency, I'm sorry, the combine the way I wanted to this year. I'm bummed out about that, so I'm not too familiar with all the players as I usually am, and the Senior Bowl. Grad school always kind of took that from me, guys, sorry. but, there's a lot of great players I saw, and honestly, they could be trying to go younger, so the Niners have something up their sleeve, so I see you, Niners. I see you. But overall, you know, good pickup here for the Colts. The last time the Colts had a serious edge rusher, they actually had two of them, and their names were Dwight Freeney and Robert Mathis. So, yeah, they're trying to recoup that, or whatever you want to call it, try and get that thing going again. So, yeah, look at that. I love it. I love it, Marcus. Yep. Marcus says here in the chat room, Colts, I see you trying to win. Colts, I see you. That's right. I see you too, Colts. Absolutely, man. The Colts are trying to do their thing right now. So... Terrence says, Marcus, Larry debates, / other debates on TV. Absolutely, man. Marcus and I could go back and forth. I love it, man, because Marcus is somebody, I greatly respect you, Marcus, and that's what I'm talking about, man. I love a good debate like that, so good stuff there, and I like it. So, great stuff. Next up, yeah, that's right, man. He's laughing my ass off. Facts, Terrence. Absolutely, LMAO. Terrence says, Brissett will stay, but Rivers will start. Heard it here first. Well, that's a possibility. I think Brissett can go somewhere and start. But Marcus says, we couldn't pay him and keep everyone. I wish we could have. I guess that makes sense. Buckner's a beast, man. And seeing him with his old college teammate, too, Eric Armstead, man, it was so cool. And he is expensive, but, man, you get what you pay for him. What you get out of DeForest Buckner is like a Bentley, man. You get everything. You get factory air, factory windows, everything. A smooth ride, you get everything. I'm telling you, he's that Cadillac, man. He DeForest Buckner is definitely get what you pay for, but sometimes you just can't afford him, and I get it. Couch Crew Chief jumps in here and says, AJ McCarron is a great pickup. He was awesome at Alabama. If he gets any consistent play ever, he is going to surprise some people. I get it, and he was good. He was good at Alabama, okay? We all know that. He was a good athlete, and he did his thing. I know the Bengals, I thought for sure they're going to replace Andy Dalton when the Bengals got him. I really did. I thought so, but they didn't. And now he's going to sit behind Watson. But you know what? Hey, I'm not hoping at all that Watson gets hurt. He is an incredible, incredible player, okay? But I guess, you know, I mean, in my opinion, the guy that's there, the guy, okay, is definitely going to be Watson for sure, Deshaun Watson. But McCarron is a great athlete, without a doubt, Couch Crew Chief. And if he stays, But he goes there and he does his thing, man. You know what? That's big. Okay, if he you know, gets some PT and gets plays, I think that can be pretty big there. So, okay, so let's continue on here. Jacksonville Jaguars. Where's that music? I couldn't get to the music fast enough. I'm sorry. We're gonna have two segments today because this is just. Hey, the Rams re-signed Whitworth. You know what? Great pickup there. I like that. I just saw that tweet right now. But, yeah, where's my music at? I'm sorry. We got to go back to this music right now. Yeah. The Jacksonville Jaguars. Well, Nick Foles is gone, which means that Gardner Minshew is your guy. He's not a bad quarterback. So, cool. Do your thing. I think he has, you know, some room to grow, and he will. Ngakoue. Okay, Yannick Ngakoue, edge rusher. They got the franchise tag on him. Awesome. Yes. Joe Schobert, linebacker. He will agree there to play in Jacksonville from the Browns. Okay, good player there. They also will sign Darquez Dennard. Yeah, great player. Great corner out of Cincinnati. That's pretty much all. The Jacksonville Jaguars need a lot of help. They were good for a little bit, but they need help. They're trying to get some help there, but yeah, I don't know. They need some more help. Yeah, that's pretty much the Jaguars right now. I don't know what's happening, but we'll find out. The Jaguars and the Browns are... I feel bad for Schobert. I mean, he's just making money, I know. He's making money playing ball, but it's like, wow, he went from the Browns... You go to from the Browns to the Jaguars. I'm sorry. Anyway, let's get on over to the chat room again. Marcus says here, McCarron is a second-string quarterback at best. Taryn says again, you are... This Are You Tripping music sounds like Animal Crossing. Very funny, Taryn. Well, it's just hilarious, because Are You Tripping? I'm sorry. I'm sorry, Jaguars, but yeah. So, okay. Next up, fun fact, Taryn, I've never played Animal Crossing. So, okay. Next up, Kansas City. Oh, yeah. Kansas City. Super Bowl champions. They don't need to do much. Chris Jones, franchise tagged him. Damian Williams, signed him. Guess what? That's all. They re-signed Damian Williams, and they will franchise tag Chris Jones. If it ain't broke, don't fix it. Good for you, Kansas City. I see you. Next up, the Las Vegas Raiders. Well, I'll tell you, I'm actually kind of pleased for the first time with the Raiders in a long time. And I guess so happens to be when we're off the field. Funny, right? Okay, anyway. In the last 48 hours, I am really happy with what we got. Eli Apple. I like it. Signed there with the Raiders. That was the most recent signing. I'll take it. Jeff Heath, that was a great pickup. Great player from the Cowboys. Okay, by the way, Eli Apple coming from the Saints. Corey Littleton coming from the Rams. That was freaking huge. Then we have Carl Nassib coming from the Tampa Bay Buccaneers. He's decent. Good player. We signed Jason Witten, which is huge, from the Cowboys. Yeah, he's up there. He's entering this, 17th season here? Or he's 17th season, so he's entering his 18th season. But you know what? Like my good buddy Trevor said, boy Trevor Smith yesterday, he's all happy because he's a big old Cowboys fan. He told me, he says, I bet he finishes the year, signs the Cowboys for one day, and retires. And then he says, and I says, you think so? And then he says, yeah, man, he's already retired once. I've seen him just wanting to hold on. I see him as just wanting to hold on. He didn't get much play time last year, and he is looking to keep the spark alive. And, yep, I guess quoted my boy Trevor from a text message. He won't mind. But, yeah, I can kind of see that. I'm not going to doubt him. He's a great player. He can bring something to us. Marcus, I completely agree. Marcus says here, Jason Witten, good for the running for the run game, and he is. And now that we have, you know, Jacob back there, man, Jacobs is a beast. He is a beast. Josh Jacobs is a beast. I'm so glad we got him. DeAndre Washington's back there. We also got Jalen Richard. We have a decent running back. Well, I don't say tandem, but we have three good running backs back there. And honestly, Yeah, Jason Witten can really add to that. Waller is also a good blocking tight end. I think Luke Wilson is still there. I don't know if he still is, but regardless, good pickup. Also, another good pickup here from the Bears, Nick Quiltz. I don't want to butcher his name, but yeah, another good pickup here. A linebacker out of, well, from the Chicago Bears. And then there was Marcus. And no, ladies and gentlemen, not Marcus Loves Great in the chat room. If you missed his show last night, it was awesome, y'all. Trust me, it was. You shouldn't have missed it. Marcus is the man. It was a great show talking about how awesome Roy Jones Jr. is, because he is, and probably one of the greatest boxers we've ever seen in history of ever. I was too young to see him fight a lot, and then I wasn't even really like that much into boxing as a young child, so I didn't get a chance to see him fight. Taryn also brought up yesterday that his track can't be shook. A great track there. I mean, I love it. I trained to that track, y'all. Like, no joke, man. He is, he's the real deal, man. Like, Roy Jones Jr., I love that track, man. And I love listening to, oh, sorry, Can't Be Tux is that track. But yeah, he's the real deal, man. And that's all there is to it. So last night, if you want to check it out, it was an awesome, awesome, awesome show last night. So if you didn't catch it, y'all, Marcus Loves Great and Gloves Off yesterday, talking about Connor and all the good stuff there. We're gonna get into other sports pretty soon on this show. My bad, but I'm just hogging it with football. But Terrence says, "Would you like to see Melvin Gordon on the Raiders next year?" There, no, I would not. He's a good player, but we got Josh Jacobs. I think he's gonna be just fine. Melvin Gordon, he might be too much of a headache. I don't know. Is what it is. If he goes, great, I'll support him. But as of right now, I think we're okay with running back. So, all right. Let's move it forward. Marcus Mariota going to the Raiders. This means that everyone has lost faith in Carr. I am pissed off about this because I really like Derek Carr. He's a good player. Raider fans, fight me. I don't care. What's up, y'all? Because seriously, he's a good player. I'm so sorry that we have hardly any weapons for this guy. Okay? I'm so sorry that our defense sucks. Like, how would you feel if you knew already that you had to freaking at least score? I mean, you should always want to score touchdowns, and I get that. But the problem is how would you feel if you knew going into every game that at some point you're going to have to freaking battle back in that game, because our defense sucks, and you might have to score 3 to 4 touchdowns a game just to be competitive. Yeah, because our defense is that bad. How would you feel? Okay, that's like going into every game down 28 points already. I mean, it's sad, but that's how bad our defense is. So everyone stop being so freaking harsh on Carr. Like, seriously, our defense was absolute trash. Our linebackers don't know what the hell they're doing. Okay, Amaro, I'm sorry. Like, our linebackers are absolutely just like, what in the hell? Tahir Whitehead is the only linebacker that's actually worth a crap, okay? And it's hilarious to see our defensive line just struggle. Okay, I mean, Hurst, Farrell, Crosby, you know what, Benson Mayowa, they're good athletes, but, you know, our run game, we held them pretty good, so I guess I can't get too much on the defensive line. They held their own, zero pass rush, but they definitely held their own in the run game, and, I mean, some kind of pass rush was there, but overall, there's nothing that impresses me whatsoever about the defensive line, really, at all, okay? Like, at all. I mean, they're good enough, but they're not elite. Linebackers, yeah. Besides Tahir Whitehead, which he didn't even do much. Yeah, nothing there. And I'm sorry, we have a secondary? I didn't know we had a secondary. I thought it was just the front seven. I really thought we just had the front seven out there, because the secondary, we don't have one. So, you know what? I know LaMarcus Joyner was there last year. I get it. At the end of the day, I think he's staying with us, but at the end of the day, it's just really, really sad to think, like, it's all Carr's fault, because it's not. It's really annoying, and yeah, Jonathan says here in the chat room, I like it. Marcus says, not Alvin Gordon's current price point, so yeah, absolutely. Jonathan says here, Carr is a great quarterback, but if you're standing behind tissue paper... Thank you, Couch. Yes, if you're standing behind tissue paper and throwing to rubber targets, you're gonna have a bad time. That is, where's that applause button? Yeah, maybe not the best time for a quarterback to have that. Exactly. It sounds like, I feel like South Park right now. the episode where they have like the montage, the 80s, where they're up in the mountains. Well, duh, they're in the mountains all the time, but they're up in, I forgot where it was. I think it was Aspen or whatever, but it's the one with the timeshare, and Stan's like fighting off that guy. He keeps on calling him Stan Darsh, and it's hilarious because there's that the instructor that's like, if you pizza, you got a pizza, and then what was the other one? I forgot what it was, but pizza or... when you're skiing, you either put your skis together to slow down, or you put your... Oh, French fry, when you're going straight. I was like, if you French fry when you're supposed to pizza, you're gonna have a bad time. Like, I feel like that's it right there. Like, that's exactly one of those things right there. Like, exactly. Thank you, Carl. Exactly. If you're standing behind tissue paper and throwing rubber targets, you're gonna have a bad time. And that's pretty much what happened with the Raiders and Derek Carr. So, yeah, thank you. Thank you, Couch. But Raider fans... gotta love him, right? Anyway, Terrence says, yeah, I would agree. I would not miss Gordon if he left the Chargers, despite my brother having bought me a Gordon jersey for Christmas. That sucks. I'm sorry, man. I'm sorry, Terrence. I hope he stays with you guys. I'm going to make a top 5 or top 10 Phil Jones moments on The Unfiltered Truth if and when the draft comes up. That's awesome. Also, got The Unfiltered Truth with Mr. Phil Jones and Phil Robson III, man. They always do a great job over there. Every Monday evening, 6:30 p.m. Pacific Time, 9:30 p.m. Eastern Time. So, all right. So, let's move it on now into the... Well, if Marcus Mariota... In closing, if Mariota's the guy, then good. Cool. But if he's not, okay. I mean, whoever it is, hopefully they can keep both of them and have a competition. And if one's doing bad, pull out the other. That would be great. But don't try and get rid of Carr, y'all. I think he's a great quarterback. And I still think he's the guy for the job in Vegas now. I was going to say Oakland, but in Vegas. All right. Los Angeles Chargers, Brian Bulaga. Big time upgrade from Okung. I know. He was a little beat up. Great job there coming on over from the Packers. This is the only team other than the Packers he's ever played, man. I remember Blog when he got drafted, so good pickup there. Austin Eckler will stay there in Los Angeles. Great job. Hunter Henry, they will franchise tag him as they needed to. Linval Joseph, good job. He came on over from the Vikings. The Vikings are falling apart the seams right now. So great job there by the Chargers to sign this young man. Great tackle. Trey Turner! Hey! I know that guy. He came on over from the Panthers. Great job there. He will come with the trade for Russell Okung. Great job there for the Chargers. Overall, I see you, Chargers. You know what? They're doing their thing. Anthony Lynn's a great coach. I really do see some good stuff coming forth for them if they can get their quarterback. Next up, Los Angeles Rams. Austin Blythe. Signs to a one-year deal. Good job there. And then Leonard Floyd. This was pretty crazy from the Bears coming on over. Good job there, edge rusher. And I thought that was a great, great, great pickup for the Rams. They need another edge rusher, and you know what? Why not? Anybody on the line with Aaron Donald is going to be good. And Leonard Floyd is somebody who can really come and make some things happen. So, yeah. So they keep Austin Blythe. Really good job. And they have Floyd. Not making too much noise, but good job there. The Miami Dolphins. I see you, Miami. Yeah. Eric Flowers. Not that he's all that great, but he will sign with the Dolphins, trying to build up the offensive line. Then they went and picked up from the Patriots, Ted Karras. Good player there. Then they go grab Byron Jones. Remember him? The guy a couple years ago who jumped out of the stadium in the combine with all of his jumps? Yeah, the guy is a really good athlete. Guess what? He's heading on over to Miami. Okay. Emmanuel Ogba. Another big-time player here, a defensive end out of Kansas City. Good pickup. Guess who else they went and got? Shaq Lawson from the Buffalo Bills. Really good job. And then the cherry on top. The icing was everybody else. The cherry on top is Kyle Van Noy. This is amazing, man. They got him to sign for 4 years to the Dolphins. Miami Dolphins, I see you. I see you. Yes. What a job by the Dolphins. Dolphins fans should be pretty happy right now. They did a really good job in free agency. And I want to see them continue it. Minnesota Vikings are just not having a good time right now. CJ Ham, he'll resign. Yay. Their fullback here, Anthony Harris, he will stay. Yay. And then we have, of course, Eric Wilson. He will stay. Yay. That's pretty much it. And then going with the teams with all the players they lost. Not yay, boo. Yeah, the Vikings, I don't know. Last year, they were on the redemption route. They were doing really good. this year, I don't know, they've lost some significant players. I hope they have a good free agency and a good draft, because as of right now, the Vikes, damn it, just when I'm starting to believe in them again. Really. But, and yes, Taryn, I said a little bit ago that Andrew Whitworth just re-signed with the Rams. And great pickup there, big monster tackle. He was with the Bengals for a long time, and he's done really good in Los Angeles, so I hope he does his thing there. Okay, next up, this was pretty awesome. The New England Patriots. Actually, you know what? How about this? Let me get some freaking water. So with that said, y'all, let's go ahead and take ourselves a quick break. When we get back, I'll finish off free agency for at least to the moment and give us some more sports. We are going to run the distance today, y'all. We're going to go 3 hours. Why? Because I want to. I literally have nothing else to do right now. Like, literally, there's no sports. My schooling's done for the day. Like, yeah, I don't have much else to do. So I'm going to talk sports with y'all. That's what we're doing today. Yeah. So with that said, y'all, let's get it. When we return, we're going to finish off free agency. We're going to talk about the Canelo fight. We're going to talk, well, Canelo and Golovkin 3. We are going to get into a little bit of news from other sports, not there's much, and that's what's going to happen. So hopefully you've enjoyed our new segments, and if you didn't like our new segments, well then, tough luck, because they're here to stay. So with that said, y'all, we will get back to you on the other side of this break. Once again, you're listening to The Defining Moment right here on IE Sports Radio, your direct feed for all that is sports. We'll be right back after this.
Good evening, sports fans. This is me, your boy, Levy, bringing you yet another action-packed, wall-to-wall episode of The Defining Moment right here on IE Sports Radio, your direct feed for all that is sports. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. It's your boy, Phil Robinson, here at IE Sports Radio, taking this moment to welcome you to storm down the lane on the Fast Break Show with me and my man, Phil Jones, right now.
Hey everybody, it's the host of the fastest show on IE Sports Radio, Daryl Kinsey Jr. And I'm welcoming you to take a lap of the extra mile with me and my co-host Lolita Camello, Caitlin Seen, and Michael Ward as we go through all of the news and updates in NASCAR, Formula One, IndyCar, and more. That's the extra mile, Thursdays at 8 p.m. on IE Sports Radio.
Hello, lovelies. Caitlin Seem here, host of Not What It Seems, where nothing is off limits and no sport is safe. On IE Sports Radio, your direct feed for all that is sports.
Two Wheels Wednesday with Matt White, taking you inside the pit lane of British Superbike, World Superbike, and the big one, MotoGP.
Hey everyone, this is Felicia, the first lady of IE Sports Radio and one of your esteemed co-hosts of Ring Rambling Radio, along with Martine Sandoval and Matt Petrushka, for all of your wrestling news and talk from everything from WWE to Ring of Honor, All Elite Wrestling, New Japan, anything you like. Be sure to catch us right here on IE Sports Radio.
Hey there, hockey fans. This is Cal Henderson
with Nico Green.
And we are welcoming you to join us on the Neutral Zone presented by IE Sports Radio throughout the hockey season.
Buddy, let me tell you, hockey's never been hotter, and neither has the Neutral Zone.
You definitely don't want to miss it, so tune in to YouTube.com, IE Sports Radio, or IESportsRadio.com for all things that are hockey.
Hey, everyone. This is your boy, Phil Jones, co-host of the Unfiltered Truth with Phil Robinson III. Every Monday, 3:30, 6:30, and Tuesday, 5:30, 8:30. On IE Sports Radio, we're here to give you guys nothing but Raider news, breakdowns of both sides of the game, and interviews with active and former players and NFL analysts, because we are here to give you nothing but the unfiltered truth. We want you guys to get the real stuff. So join us every Monday night and Tuesday night on IE Sports Radio.
What's going on, football fans? This is me, your boy, Larry, inviting you to join myself, Callum Reynolds, Mike Pat, and John Felipe for one of the most electrifying football shows you have ever heard. Three and Out, right here on iSports Radio. Recap of the week before, a preview of what's to come, and of course, three hardcore head-to-head primetime face-offs each week. You don't want to miss it.
You love racing, and we love racing. So join myself, Lolita Camello, with my co-hosts, Daryl Kinsey Jr., Caitlin C., and Michael Ward, as we talk racing on the Extra Mile here every Thursday at 8 p.m. Eastern on the IE Sports Radio Network, your direct feed for all that is sports.
Oh, yeah, if you're a fan of professional wrestling, if you're a fan of WWE, if you're a fan of All Elite Wrestling, if you're a fan of the sport of professional wrestling, you're in the right place. Hello, I am the SoCal Saint, Martin Sandoval, coming to you live with Ring Rambling Radio, along with the First Lady of IE Sports Radio, Felicia, and my good brother, Matt Petreska. It's Ring Rambling Radio, part of IE Sports Radio. Dig it!
Hello and welcome to the Soccer Scoreboard Show with your host, Gabriel Montoya. This is the show for soccer, football fans, or whatever you call the beautiful game. Every week, I tackle the latest and greatest news from around the soccer world, from the English Premier League to the World Cup to MLS, Liga MX, and more. You can listen to the Soccer Scoreboard Show and our lineup of fantastic guests every Friday at noon here on IE Sports Radio, your direct feed for all that is sports.
Are you a big fan of baseball? Well, then join us every Tuesday on the International Empire Sports Radio Network. I'm your host, Brandon Buckingham. I have my co-host, Karen Rodriguez, and Blake Henley. Join me every week when we will discuss the latest in sports. See you then.
What's up, IE Sports Radio family? This is John Felipe, one half of the Brothers Blue, coming to you from Charlotte, North Carolina. You can catch me on any one of those shows on 3 and Out, on The Brothers Blue on YouTube, as well as IE Sports Radio, your home for all that is sports.
Warning, warning, the following opinions are not sanctioned by IE Sports Radio. The truth is a beautiful thing. We would never twist it, nor will it ever be sugar-coated. So prepare yourself. I'm Phil Robinson, he's Phil Jones, and this is the unfiltered truth.
Hello, this is Michael Ward from The Extra Mile, and you're listening to IE Sports Radio, your direct feed for all that is sports.
Hey, IE Sports Radio family, this your boy, Mr. Gumbo himself, Caleb Fat Mac Reynolds. What up? You know I'm part of the Defining Moment NBA segment and also 3 and Out. Holla at your boy from the Big Easy all the way to your front door. This is IE Sports Radio, your home for all that is sports.
Hey guys, it's Blake Henley, better known as H-Town Blake to some of you. Happy to announce that Bases Loaded is back and in full force. We'll be bringing that high heat every Tuesday night here on IE Sports Radio. So come home, get ready, dig into that batter's box, and see if you can chase that high heat, baby. So we'll be coming to you live with all the stats, all the rundowns, all the division rivalries, and every team that's going to make the playoff push to get to that one and only October and get to the pinnacle of what baseball is, to hoist that commissioner's trophy when it's all said and done.
This is your road pista, the Kurt Man. You can catch me each month alongside Vince Wright, sports governor of Minnesota, talking boxing on IE Sports Radio.
Hello, sports fans. This is Mike Pat, co-host of 3 and Out NFL Edition, editor of the IE Sports Radio blog, diehard Redskins fan, alumni of the Florida State University, and all-around sports fanatic. Come check out my stuff and more on IE Sports Radio, your feed for all that is sports.
Hey, this is your boy Phil Jones, also the host of the Fast Break Show, with Phil Robinson III joining me as my sidekick as always. Look, we come at you guys every Friday night at 5 p.m., 8 p.m. Eastern. Look, we give you guys all the latest NBA news from NCAA as well and the WNBA. We also let you guys know pregame, injuries, whatever you need to know for basketball, for your fantasy league as well. So look, y'all tune in for the Fast Break Show every Friday night at 5 p.m. Pacific Time, 8 p.m. Pacific, 8 Eastern on IE Sports Radio. Y'all take care.
What's good, everybody? My name is Taryn Rodriguez, co-host for Bases Loaded. You can catch me, Brandon Buckingham, and Blake Henley on Bases Loaded at 7 p.m. Pacific Time, 10 p.m. Eastern Time on IE Sports Radio. It's sure to be a grand slam.
This is Matt Petreschko, one half of the Good Brothers of Ring Ramblin' Radio, with Martine Sandoval and Felicia Ruizrager. And you can catch us each month talking everything wrestling right here on IE Sports Radio, your home for all that is sports.
Do you love college football? And do you want to hear a college football show dedicated to all that is college football, including junior college, and the CCAA, and the NJCAA, the NAIA, and the NCAA, including Division III, Division II, Division I AA in the FCS, and Division I single A in the FBS? Well, then look no further. Join myself, Larry B., and my colleagues, Mr. H-Town Blake, Blake Henley, and Mr. Christian Espinoza, each week during the college football season for the latest in college football on 3 and Out College Edition, right here on IE Sports Radio, your direct feed for all that is sports.
Hi, I'm Brian McLaughlin. In the National Football League, there are approximately 17 million total fans.
I'm Andrew Guzman. My Dallas Cowboys make up almost 9 million of those fans.
And my Seahawks have a very loyal fan base of around 4 million.
That's more than three quarters of all the fans.
That's absolutely correct, Andrew. And on the Common Ground Football Podcast, we'll be talking about the good, bad, and the ugly of these teams.
We'll have weekly picks, discuss transactions, injuries.
And we'll chat about the rest of the league, too.
Blake freaking Bortles?
Oh, yes. And Captain Andrew Luck.
Excellent. What about Fitzmagic?
Oh, let's not get carried away now.
Oh, all right, then.
Join us each week at commongroundfootballpodcast.com or wherever you get your podcast.
It's going to be
awesome.
Hey, what's up, sports fans? You looking for a different type of sports talk show? Something you haven't heard before? You got to check out the BS3 Sports Show every other Saturday on Two Live Stews Radio, 1 p.m. Central Time, 2 p.m. Eastern. Sports talk at its finest. Always have great guests playing some good hip-hop. You don't want to miss it. Make sure to tune in to the BS3 Sports Show every other Saturday at 1 p.m. Central Time, 2 p.m. Eastern.
Welcome back, sports fans. All right, well, as you can see, some of these things are dated. I was sitting here eating orange real quick. Yeah, some of these things are dated. We need to re-record some of those. of course, a network commercials and that was last summer. And you know, Ben has some more commercials. I have some more of his recent stuff too. But big ups. We got to do some of our recording. I have nothing to do right now, so we gotta get some new drops recorded. Taryn here in the chat room promoting his show, which he does a great job, y'all. If you haven't caught Set Point, man, show him some love. He does a lot. He actually does a lot. A lot goes into that show, man. So you gotta show some love to Taryn. And Marcus has become a big fan of that show. He's a GCU guy, and GCU is a damn good freaking volleyball team. Like, those cats can play. So should I say those loops can play. So yeah, man, big ups to Tara Rodriguez. We gotta get Marcus a drop now for his show, which, man, we gotta get it over that entrance music. Marcus's entrance music is epic, man. I love his theme music for Gloves Off, man. Great stuff there. So, all right, y'all. Well, with that said, let's go ahead and get on the road here with some more good stuff here. With some more free agency. So, I'm just going to skim through the rest of this, y'all. We don't got a lot to go. So, let's make it short and sweet. So, the Patriots, as you can see, they're kind of falling apart a little bit. Demir Bird will sign from the Cardinals, a wide receiver there. They needed him. They're going to keep Devin McCourty. They're going to keep Matthew Slater. And they're going to franchise tag Joe Thuney. At least they're keeping their line together. Other than that, I don't know. There could be some rough times ahead. Just saying. For the Pats, I don't know. But they're still a dynasty. Until Belichick leaves, they're still a dynasty. And I am convinced, and I will continue to say that. So, exactly, yeah. What Terrence says here, Marcus's intro for Gloves Off is 100 and absolutely is, man. Awesome intro music, man. I love it. So, all right. With that said, let's go ahead and roll on now to the Saints. Breeze, of course, resigns. Big time signing there. And Malcolm Jenkins goes back home. They drafted him, then they let him go, and now he's back. And honestly, you can tell, he loved being a Saint. You know he did. He got drafted there. There's usually a special place in your heart for wherever you get drafted to. He did a great job. He really did play extremely well there, and I'm so happy to see that. The Cardinals signed Devon Kennard. All right, Cardinals, how about I see you. That is a good pickup. That is a very good pickup. I am really happy about that. Kennard played for the Giants a little bit. It was just, he needed to get out of there. He needed to go somewhere else. And honestly, you know, T-Sizzle's no longer there, so I like this a lot. I mean, he was only there for a little bit. But you know what? Devon Kennard, USC product right there, heading on over to the Cardinals. I like that. I just got that tweet right now, so great job for the Cardinals signing him. He's a great young man, great, great player. So speaking of those Giants, actually, well, real quick, too, David Onyemata, I don't want to butcher his name, but he will also resign. Defensive tackle will resign with the Saints. Then we have the Giants. They will sign James Bradbury, which is a pretty good signing as well, from the Panthers. You can see their cleaning house. Kyler Fackrell out of the Packers will head on over to the Giants. Blake Martinez will also join him, heading on over to from the Packers to the Giants. Big moves here in the linebacker core. And David Mayo. Where is he from again? Oh, yeah. He was a gosh damn Patriot. Well, then he went on to the Giants. But, yeah, I think it was a Patriot. But still, good pickup there. Levian Toilolo, tight end, big tight end from the Niners. Hey, they got their boy over there, George Kittle, all day long. So great pickup there. And then one of the biggest pickups of the entire, I really love this, one of the biggest freaking pickups that you can imagine, okay, came on over. He's going to stay in the same stadium, but Leonard Williams, another USC guy, will stay in MetLife Stadium but be wearing blue instead of green now as he plays for the Giants. Great job. You know what? Now with Chase Daniel back behind quarterback, behind center, I really like what the Giants are doing. This is big. I think the Giants have some great road ahead of them. As for the other team that plays in MetLife, yeah. I mean, don't get me wrong. The pickup of Brian Poole, or the re-signing, was good. They need him to stay at corner. Connor McGovern, really good pickup there at center from the Cowboys. And George Font from the Seattle Seahawks. Good job. As well as Alex Lewis. Sorry, I skipped him. He will resign. Keeping the offensive line intact. Keeping their corner. Just keeping everybody. Good job. But they're gonna need to make some moves, guys. They can't keep that same team they had last year or close to it and expect to be competitive. I know that the monster is pretty much out of the, well, not out, but you know, I feel like the AFC East is a little bit more of a level playing field now without Brady. But don't forget, Belichick is still there, and whoever he gets, they'll still be pretty good, I'm sure. But I don't know. I just feel like it's a little more of a level playing field now. The Eagles, John Hargrave at nose tackle. Great job, guys. Big man out of from the Steelers. That was a good pickup. Safety from the Eagles will stay, Rodney McLeod. And then you have here James Mills also staying and Nate Sutfield also staying. Okay, so he's the back quarterback. But Mills and McLeod are great, good. You need to keep those guys back there. When you got great things, keep them. Do everything you can to keep them. So the Eagles looking pretty okay there, but still, they're going to still need to go make some things happen. They have some big-time departures this year. They're going to need to go see make some things happen. As for the Pittsburgh Steelers, Bud Dupree, this was such a great job. by them to keep to franchise tag him, because you know what? You need him. You need Dupree, okay? You need Bud Dupree. He is a great athlete, and you want him. You want to keep him. They also, like, you know, they have TJ Watt. He's a freaking beast. You need to keep that defense as intact as you can. Then they went and signed Derek Watt, which is awesome, because now we have two Watt brothers playing on the same team. And I think this is going to be really cool. I tweeted something yesterday, like, oh yeah, it's going to be fun at practice and even funner at games. Like, it's going to be awesome to see these two guys play on the same team. And, yep, yeah, hey, well, here we go, Steelers. I like it. And they need to make some moves. Big Ben's getting up there in age. Will Cam be there next? He's a big mole guy, a lot like Ben was, or is, but, you know, will he be, who will be where? You know, that's pretty exciting. So I like that. I like the fact that right now we have a young, you know, the younger Watt going on over there, but the Steelers still need some help. The Niners, Eric Armstead re-signing, they needed to. Ben Garland re-signing, he needed to. Jimmy Ward resigning, they needed to. They resigned lots of top players. They cleared up some cap with Bingo of DeForest Buckner. You know what? Seriously, guys, I don't think the Niners are going to be much different than last year. They're going to be dominant. They're going to do really well. And they're going to do it with a lot of the same core players I had last year. I really like what I see in the Niners right now. So, Marcus, your team, man, at least from my perspective, which we all have opinions, and mine is just as good as anybody else's, but from my perspective, I think, from my opinion, the Niners are going to be pretty damn good. As for the Seahawks, this was, you know, rough, because I don't know what's going to happen with Clowney. I don't know if he's going to go, which there's a big possibility he will. They need somebody off the edge, but B.J. Finney, from the Steelers will head on over. They will keep Jacob Hollister at tight end. So, Finney, offensive lineman. Jacob Hollister at tight end. He stays. They sign Greg Olsen, which is pretty damn big because he's a really good athlete. And it's really exciting to see how well he has continued to play. It was cool how he was commentating XFL games and still playing in the NFL. But he's going to go on over there. I think him and Russell Wilson are going to have a good run together. And then they re-sign Jerron Reed at defensive tackle. So good stuff there for the Seahawks. Tampa Bay, of course, we all know the elephant in the room, Tom Brady, heading on over now. This is completely and utterly insane. But Tom Brady heading down to Tampa, going from the nice, from the freezing cold northwest, or sorry, northeast, down to the nice and sunny southeast in Florida. So we all know he is going to be playing there for the Tampa Buccaneers. That was insane, but I don't know. I mean, now for Jameis Winston, we don't know what's going to happen, but we shall see. But yeah, there you go. And then Jason Pierre-Paul will re-sign with the Buccaneers as well. Also, Shaquille Barrett will have the franchise tag placed on him. So as of right now, that Bay hasn't really lost too much. But it seems that time they just need to, I don't know. I feel like they got Brady. That's cool. But I mean, he's 43. He is the greatest quarterback of all time, but Father Time is undefeated. How long will he be there? Will they have an offensive line provided for him? I mean, I know Ali Marpet's a beast. Out of Division 3, Hobart. I just got to say that every time, but I don't know. I mean, we'll find out, but that's the Buccaneers at the moment. Tennessee, I see you, Tennessee. Vic Beasley, I told y'all, man. I told y'all, Vic Beasley is a gosh damn monster. I am so excited because he's not that he didn't have a fair chance, but you got a linebacker coach. He was a linebacker, a legendary linebacker for the Patriots. He played great football, and Mike Vrabel knows what goes into that and what goes into being a great linebacker. I think he's like, let me get Vic Beasley and make him into what I want to make him. And honestly, he has all that talent. I think this is a great move. They picked him up. Derrick Henry, they placed a franchise tag on him because, what, you need to. This guy's a freak of nature, breaking records and doing awesome things on his birthday and doing big things there. So, also, Dennis Kelly, they will sign him, which is pretty damn big. I mean, they'll keep him, actually. And then Ryan Tannehill, they keep him as well. Which, of course, that's their guy right now. So, you know, Tennessee, I see you. I really like what they're doing. I really do like what they're doing in Tennessee. Mike Vrabel's the guy over there. And Marcus says, get Mike Evans in fantasy this year. And yes, that's right, man. Godwin. I mean, look at all they have over there right now. Like, For real? Right now, the Patriots. Right now, the Tampa Buccaneers, man, they got a lot of talent over there right now. They got a lot of big things. And this is going to be really exciting, like, to see this offense commanded by Tom Brady. So, yeah, I completely agree with you there, Marcus. Get Mike Evans, because he's already that damn good, okay? He's really good, okay? Also, Cameron Brate. Yeah, he's somebody else to tie it in there. So, okay, and then we have here two more teams to take a look at. Actually, the Vikings aren't even on here, because they haven't even done anything. Actually, no, that was already earlier, I'm sorry. I don't know why I was thinking V, but yeah. The team, not the city name. But okay, so, next up here, last but not least, we have the Washington Redskins. Sean Davis, safety, he will agree to, what did he get? He's from the Steelers, that is, a one-year deal. Thomas Davis, linebacker here, coming out of the Chargers. Kendall Fuller, coming from the Chiefs. You have Kevin Pierre-Lewis coming from the Bears. Brandon Scherff, who is a damn machine, okay, he is re-signing. And Wes Schweitzer, I don't want to butcher his name, coming from the Falcons. Guard. So, yeah, you gained a safety, two linebackers, a corner, you're keeping your monster guard, and you get signed another guard. Now they have Ron Rivera commanding, and they got all these pieces there, and you still have Kerrigan, and you have Sweat. Seriously, you have Montez Sweat? Yeah, this is pretty good. I like this. The Redskins could be doing something this year, so I'm excited for them, y'all. So, with that said, that's a little bit of a look at free agency there, and yeah, so I know that was pretty much the entire show, my apologies. So, let's go ahead and jump on into some other things real quick, y'all. As a matter of fact, you know, let's take one more break, and then when we get back, we're gonna have some fun talking about the rest of the sports world. I'm gonna poke some fun at some things, just because, I don't care. Like I said, I'm bored, and that'll be that. So, once again, this final break here of the afternoon, you're listening to The Defining Moment, right here on Ike Sports Radio, your direct feed for all that is sports. We'll see you right after this.
Hi, everybody. It's Calvin here from USRN, here to give you an important message. Since 2017, we have done our absolute best to provide you with nothing but the highest quality of sports calls in the greatest of quantity possible. Thanks to you, our station has grown more than we ever thought. That's why, with your help, we would like to grow even further. Just think, twice the amount of your favorite calls, 24 hours of coverage, talk shows, play-by-play, game-by-game analysis, and so much more. That's right, USRN2 is officially in development. But we can't do it alone. We have set up a GoFundMe page that you can access from our homepage on the left of your screen. We also are planning special giveaways and prizes to our highest donors. Our goal here at USRN is to bring you the best calls possible at no cost to you. In order to continue to do that, we need your help now. Please check out our GoFundMe page, and if you would like to know how you can help, you can email usrnradio@gmail.com. Without your support, we couldn't do what we do.
Ladies and gentlemen, hear me and hear me good. If you like sports, then you like the Wait a Minute Show. If you like comedy, then you like the Wait a Minute Show. If you like a different opinion coming from a different angle, then you like the Wait a Minute Show. So join me Saturday, 8 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, with your host, Jelani J.B. Bodie, and of course, my man Lopan, on the Wait a Minute Show. Ain't that right, Lopan?
Lopan, they didn't even want you. They didn't even want me. But you know what? Right about now, they have no choice. Looking for the real sports talk? Talk that's for us, the people? Look no further. The Wait a Minute Show, a prime time sports comedy cocktail that tucks you in at night. Join me and Lopan
Wednesdays at 9 p.m. Eastern Standard Time on the 2LiveStewsRadio.com and Saturday, 8 p.m. Eastern Standard Time on the Wait a Minute Show.com. Sounds like a plan to me. Ain't that right, Lopan?
BS3 sports fans, if you love listening to the BS3 sports show, check out the weekend wrap up every Monday at 12:15 Central Time, 1:15 Eastern, recapping the weekend in sports like you never heard it before. Comedy, interactive chat room, it's a must listen. Weekend wrap up on Spreaker.com, part of the X Squad. Check it out. You won't be disappointed.
Hey, what's going on, everybody? Vince Wright, the sports governor from the great state of Minnesota, and I want to thank you for listening to Sports Done Right. Make sure you're checking us out on all of our platforms, whether it's Spreaker.com, XSquadAffiliates.com. We're also heard on the Stewart Media and Entertainment Network, so keep it tuned here. More great things coming from Sports Done Right.
Hey, USRN fans, do you have a product or company you're trying to promote? Look no further. USRN is teaming up with small local businesses trying to establish themselves via online promotion. Let us know if you're interested. Email us at usrnradio@gmail.com to learn more.
With your host, Caitlin Seam, bringing you sports like you've never heard before. Catch me Thursdays at 5 p.m. Eastern, 2 p.m. Pacific, right here on IE Sports Radio. The only question is, are you ready?
College football, and do you want to hear a college football show dedicated to all that is college football, including junior college, and the CCAA, and the NJCAA, the NAIA, and the NCAA, including Division III, Division II, Division I AA in the FCS, and Division I Single A in the FBS? Well, then look no further. Join myself, Larry B, and my colleagues, Mr. H-Town Blake, Blake Henley, and Mr. Christian Espinoza, each week
during the college football season for the latest in college football on Three and Out College Edition, right here on IE Sports Radio, your direct feed for all that is sports.
On the BS3 Sports Show.
Welcome to the BS3 Sports Podcast. We hope your experience with us is amazing. Sports talk, comedy, social issues, and more. BS3 is the best source.
Can you dig it, you sucker?
What's going on, football fans? This is Mia Barlaby inviting you to join myself, Colin Reynolds, Mike Pat, and John Felipe for one of the most electrifying football shows you have ever heard. Three and Out, right here at IE Sports Radio. Recap of the week before, a preview of what's to come, and of course, three hardcore head-to-head primetime face-offs each week. You don't want to miss it. Welcome back, sports fans.
Alrighty. Yeah, I went and got some water and hung out for a little bit because, well, you know, got some commercial time. Good stuff there. But I am back. And the chat room, once again, thank y'all for being up in here. Taryn, Jameis Winston is going to be a free agent, yes, and well, the most top remaining free agent. He is going to be interesting. It's going to be interesting to see where he goes. I love to see where he goes because he can make a splash. Marcus and Green and D. Taryn, and then I recommend the weekend wrap-up show. Yes, Taryn, great show, man. And yes, Taryn, yes. You got to love Taryn, man. He loves, if it's anything Taryn loves to do, is correct people. Just kidding. But Taryn cracks me up. I'm just kidding, Taryn. I'm just messing with you, man. But yes, like I said, a lot of these commercials are dated. My commercials. It's just, that's why I think from now on what we got to do is we got to just say the time. I mean, just give no time, but give like a day. Or just say like each week for our drops, because it happens, guys. We move around our show so much and things happen. So I'm just playing with you, Taryn. But we got to, you know, I think this is one thing we got to do a lot of now is just not give a specific day and time, because we all move around a lot. We do a lot. So, So Jonathan's up here in the chat room, says Jameis Winston is available. I wonder if IE Sports could sign him. I'll buy the lobster. You're too much couch. By the way, Couch Crew, I'm telling you, man, I'm going to wait for them to announce it, but my gosh, the stir of things that'll be going on in the next couple of weeks is going to be awesome. Like I said, we all got to step our game up because the Extra Mile team is on it right now. Lots of awesome news and great guests and lots of things happening over there with that group. So, amazing group and very talented and just super excited, y'all. Once again, Daryl Kinsey Jr. and Miss Caitlin Seam doing lots of big things with the Extra Mile. And, of course, in our PR department, Jonathan, of course, Couch Crew Chief, doing his thing. So we appreciate you, brother. Appreciate you all for what y'all do. Taryn, as well as Marcus. Taryn with set point, Marcus with gloves off. Great people, and this is why we do it, y'all. So, all right, talk a little bit more sports. Got a little bit longer here left in the show. So, unfortunately, four Nets players all got the coronavirus, one of them being Kevin Durant, which really sucks. So, that's a thing. And I just really hope and pray that all of them, Donovan Mitchell and Rudy Gobert from the Utah Jazz, and anybody else who's gotten that virus, man. Like, I've seen it so happen now. Like, I've literally seen so many players, one of the players from the NHL, I think he was from the Sentinel, from the the Ottawa Senators. I just hope and pray for everybody who has it, that God takes it away and takes it away from all of us. But yes, it sucks seeing people infected with this thing. I don't care if they're athletes or not. Just get this thing out of here already. That's why I have no issue with staying home and not doing much. The gyms are all closed now, so I'm literally working at home with all my equipment, looking to add some more pieces for my home gym here. Nothing. I mean, my work is closed. Working for a school district, I mean, it's closed. I mean, everything's closed, yeah. I mean, a lot of things are closed. They closed Disneyland, they're closing theme parks, closing a lot of things, so it's for the greater good, though, so this whole crap can pass. So anyway, with that said, there is no mark on the return of really anything. The NBA season, they're optimistic about it returning, but you heard me on Monday, I'm not going to go over that again, but it's just smart to cancel the season because it was so late already in the season. Let's just cancel it and start again next year or in October. The same thing with the NHL. No use in doing the playoffs and extending all that, and then unfortunately having a terrible either a shortened season next year at the start of it, or these guys hardly getting any rest and getting right back into it like a month later. Like, none of that, you know? So I just really hope we cancel it. For MLB, maybe we can start in the second half of the season, have a really short season on the other side of the All-Star break in the summer. We'll see if that happens. Lamar, as I mentioned, has been moved from its regular spot in June to September. I mean, that's a thing now. Formula One, it was just supposed to start last weekend, so you know, nothing on that yet, but those are still seasons who can be saved. NASCAR can still be saved. NASCAR is so long, yo. You don't understand. These drivers, and Formula One is soon to be that way, because Formula One is, like, ridiculous. They start in March and end at the very end of November, and more than likely now end of December. NASCAR starts in February and ends in November, so it's like it's a long season, y'all. Same thing with MotoGP. Those guys start early, like they start March and end in November. IndyCar is a little bit shorter. They start in March and end in September, so those are just, you know, kind of there. NHRA is a little bit different, because NHRA starts in February and ends in November, and it's a long season. It's 11 months, but they get a lot of breaks in between, so it's not super crazy, you know. They do get that month off in January, but it's nothing really big, you know. They don't really get a lot of time off, but same as that time, they do get time off, like, during, like, they get other weeks, like, weeks in between in their season, so that's a little bit different. But regardless, it's still a lot, and it's a little season, and still a lot that put into it. But other than that, that's pretty much it, you know. Vegas has canceled all of, like, everything there, like, for fights coming up and the whole bit, so that's all happening. But there are a few things to take a look at, since we, you know, don't know when, how long this is gonna last. But we do know that there's a chance that we can come back and, you know, whenever things get situated. So, with that said, now it's time to have a little bit of fun with looking around at what could possibly happen. So, boxing. Yesterday, of course, you hear a whole bunch of boxing with Mr. Marcus, those great on gloves off. Canelo, Triple G 3. Last night, it was awesome hearing Marcus talk about those two fighters, and really, I couldn't agree more with what he said. He said it before, and I'm just reiterating what he said and then agreeing with him again on his show. But I'll tell you, in the chat room last night, but I'll tell you this. The first fight, Triple G absolutely won it. I don't know how that was a draw. It was close, but Triple G won that fight. The next fight, Canelo won hands down. And this next fight should be good. But Canelo is younger, a lot younger. He's, like, in his complete prime right now. I don't want to say Triple G's best years are behind him, but they're certainly not in front of him. And he is still kind of in those good years, but he's not in, like, the peak part anymore. Like, if he's in his good years, he's in, like, his last two or maybe two, because he's, like, what, 36 now, 37? So he's good enough to be hanging around that long, to be good, like, at the level he's fighting at. But I don't know. Canelo is a gosh damn monster at the moment, and he's doing everything he can to remain, I mean, as dominant as he is. So personally, I just think that Canelo is probably going to win this thing. I don't want to say handedly, but I do have Canelo winning this game.
Okay. With that said, let's go ahead now and get on in to, let's see, I know McGregor's supposed to have a fight coming up on here, but you heard it from Marcus. I'm not a big UFC guys, UFC fan guys, but Marcus told you all about that the other day, but apparently Conor will be coming back to fight. Don't know when that's going to be. I know, I should have paid attention last night a little bit more, I bet. But, you know, so that's the combat world a little bit. Now, as we jump into everything else, basketball, as we know, completely canceled. For all college sports have been canceled. The XFL is going to start again next year. And a whole bunch of crap just happened in the sports world. Regardless, which is pretty cool, regardless, we're going to do something pretty neat here at iSports Radio that can keep you all engaged. And we're going to do our thing here with our very own style of March Madness. So we're going to pick the best of basketball, the best teams in basketball, football, soccer, hockey. Okay, sound like fun? Yeah. Okay. And then we're going to put them all together in a big, like, March Madness-style group and have the voting polls open to see who you think would win those particular games. We're going to do the same thing in boxing. We're going to take three. This is going to be 32, by the way. A field of 32. Then we're getting boxing. We're gonna cut four. So we're gonna do four different divisions, weight divisions, and cut those into eight, where we put the best against the best and see who you, the listeners, want in boxing. And then drivers, we're gonna cut it into four different classes and have some fun there. NHRA, Formula One, NASCAR, and IndyCar, and have a little fun there. So I tried to get it going this week, but this kind of ran out of time. Next week, we're going to get it more, and maybe the week after that, if we can get everything situated, just because guess what? We are going to have a lot of time coming up, so we're going to start doing stuff like that. So this, of course, is Why We Love Sports Week. I talked about why I love sports and how I got into them on Monday's show, but that's this week's theme. Next week, we're going to have another theme for you. We're going to vote on it as a team and get that kind of thing going on this week. And then next week, we're going to have more themes. And just keep it going, y'all. We're going to keep it going with the different themes and with the news coming out of whatever we can, you know, salvage in the sports world. Of course, free agency is huge. We spent, like, the majority of all of our time today on that. And that was a lot of fun, but that's going to be a big thing. We know the draft is going to be not shown, the draft is going to be shown, not a physical thing, not a place you can go see it, not in Vegas no more, but it will be on the internet, or it will be probably on the internet to live stream, and it probably will be on TV somewhere, but that's going to happen. And then another matter that I wanted to bring up, you guys, is something that I wanted to kind of give the listeners here. And everybody, I want your thoughts on us. Because Kirk Bush said it good the other day, as I mentioned, that the fans, having a fanless race would just be ridiculous. Because it's true. He says, we do it for the fans. We do it because we love it. But, it's, you know, it's the fans. They feed off the fans. Well, there's also another... It's called sports entertainment, of course. And this is the WWE wrestling. Or any other wrestling promotion. But... what I gotta say is, you know what? Big ups to Vince McMahon. I gotta give this guy so much credit. Because he's a businessman, and he performs to the top of his ability. WrestleMania is actually going to be televised this year, but it's gonna be fanless at the training center. I think that's in Tampa Bay. So they're going to have the entire WrestleMania, okay, but guess what? If they do WrestleMania, I mean, if it's fanless and they do WrestleMania, I guess... want to hear what you guys have to say about that. Because WrestleMania... wrestling is feeding off the fans. That's huge. That is huge. The fans, of course, is sports. Just like sports are fans. Like, I mean, it goes back and forth. But the big part about this whole thing is guess what? All those moves... all of the looking into the crowd and feeding off of the crowd and all that.
that's fan driven, guys. If you don't have that, it's just scripted athletics. Because that's what wrestling is. It's not fake because the injuries are real. Everything is real. But it's scripted. And I just watched Fight with my family, the story of Paige. That was pretty cool. I don't watch wrestling. I haven't watched wrestling since 2001. I'm not really a fan anymore, but I like to, you know, I'll keep up with the storyline every now and then, just see what's happening. Right? I'm not a wrestling fan whatsoever, but I did see that movie, and that kind of sparked me a little bit into wrestling again, because she's really pretty. The actress and the real Paige is pretty too. But overall, y'all, the... Wrestling is heavily off the fans. So, though it is WrestleMania, and recently, as you've heard from, and they are currently on hiatus, but from Ring Rambling Radio, Martin Sandoval and Felicia Ruiz and Matt Patricia, you know, they've said it before that these shows are getting really long, of course, they're like 5-6 hours now, 7 hours, WrestleMania, and that's a long time. But, my gosh, can you imagine a big, long show like that at the training facility? And there's no fans. This is a little concerning. Now, I give Vince McMahon a lot of props and credit because he's like, screw it. If we can't do it with people, then we gotta find a way to do it. We're not gonna not do it. I give him credit for that because, yes, this is business, of course, but... You know what, for the fans' sake at least, he's really pushing, and of course, this is his baby, it's his creation, so of course he wants it to go on, the show must go on with him, but, I don't know, I just feel like, it's gonna have its challenges, but it's different, to see this happen with no fans, especially in the league wrestling. So, I want your thoughts. What are your thoughts on WrestleMania not having fans? And what are your thoughts on no fans for certain sports? Could you see a fanless race in NASCAR or the NHRA or in IndyCar or Formula One? Could you see a fanless game? Because we almost had that in the XFL with Seattle and I think Houston. Correct me if I'm wrong, but I think it was Seattle and Houston or Seattle and the Wildcats or somebody, but they were supposed to have... It was the Wildcats, sorry. They were supposed to have a fanless game and it never got to that because everything was canceled before then. But we were supposed to have lots of fanless things. I personally don't think that's even... I mean, yeah, we can have that. But it just, I feel like having all people there just adds another element to sports that we don't see. The game is still the game. The game is still the game. Or the race, or whatever it is. But... And it's still the same game. No matter what. But I personally love playing in front of people. If not, it's just practice. Even if I'm playing against somebody else, it's still a game. But I literally feed off of that energy. I'm a huge extrovert, if you can't tell already. And I love feeding off of the energy of all of the people. I love doing that. I'm a teacher. You know what I mean? Like, I love that. You know, well, I'm a substitute teacher, but, you know, I'm trying to be a professor pretty soon. I love being in front of people. I love performing in front of people when it comes to... I love doing podcasts, as you can tell. But I love playing when I'm playing in front of people. And like Taryn said here, it's basically a scrimmage. And I completely agree. And he's cold-blooded. Terran says, a family stadium is nothing new for the Chargers. And Philip Rivers, who will be with the Colts. Considering they're not used to playing in front of fans. And yeah. Well, they used to play in front of fans, Terran, because not their own. Steelers, what? I'm sorry. But yeah, that's cold-blooded, but yes. But at least there's people watching. When you have no fans in a place, it kind of takes from it. Think about that, y'all. It really does. It could take from the sport itself. It's still the same game, but it's not the same product. What do you hear from commentators? You know, LeBron, pump fakes, drives to the court, and with the slam, and the crowd goes crazy. Exactly. Exactly. And the crowd goes crazy. Now imagine that without the crowd. Slam, and that's it. And that's now 25 points for LeBron today. It's still there. But it's... We know, like, the court. And then that's it. Inbound, and just sneakers on the court. And coach is yelling, and they're out there yelling for each other and all that and everything. Yeah, they're cheering on each other, and they're yelling at each other for signals and signs and all that. But there's no eruption from the crowd. There's none of that. I mean, like I say, honestly, it's when you think about fanless stuff, it's like... It's practice. It's like Terrence said, it's a scrimmage. So it really got me thinking with wrestling, how they're gonna do WrestleMania with no fans. I didn't think this deep about not having fans at first, and now I am. Personally, I don't really think they should continue anything without the fans. I feel like the players feed off of the fans. And though there are some who can probably do it and play really well, I'm pretty sure all of them can. Drivers and everybody. When it comes down to it, I don't see it. I don't see these athletes performing at their absolute highest level that they could possibly achieve without the fans. So that's my personal thoughts on that. But it's just, if you really think about it, it's not the same. Which means what for the product? Are the games going to be as good? And I'm just saying, this is hypothetical. I'm just saying, like, what if some of the NHL or NBA games were to be played this summer, or, you know, or any of the races or anything were to be, you know, raced or driven with no fans. I'm just saying. I mean, I guess the motorsports would be a little bit easier because it's so loud anyway. But when you're in silence for a basketball game or for a hockey game or for a football game, I mean, like I said, you're getting interaction from your coaches and your players and the other team and everything in all different kinds of ways. But I don't know. I just don't see it. I just don't see it being like Taryn says here. I think Taryn literally summed this up as best as you can sum this up. No fans or no crowd / fans equals no fun. And I completely agree with that. Yes, it's still, you're still getting it, but damn it, those crowds. It's a trip, because you think about that. It's like, you don't know what you got till it's gone. You know, really. And with no crowds, it's a scrimmage, like Taryn said. So yeah, I got to think about that the other day, when I was watching, like, YouTube videos on this and everything. I saw a YouTube video on it. And yeah, it's just not the same. It's kind of weird. So anyway, with that said, y'all, that's gonna pretty much do it for today's show. But I'm gonna leave y'all with something here. And we're gonna have some fun. Oh yeah, we're gonna have some fun. this is the newest segment and the final segment of today that I'm going to call Bring It Home. And the last 5 minutes of the podcast, we're going to bring it home. I'm going to wrap everything up, get out my final thoughts, get all the thank yous and everything in this last segment. And it's going to be a lot of fun. I got some awesome music. I love this music. By the way, if you guys want any of the music, if you, the new entrance theme, or you want the music for this awesome song coming up in a few minutes, of course, it's all in the notes already. I already have put it up. And the YouTube links on the notes, the show notes for the show here. So, of course, check us all out on all major podcasts. Check us out and show some love. Y'all know the drill. So with that said, y'all, I just want to thank everybody for tuning in. It has been a fun show. Thank you all so much for tuning in each and every week. I'm telling you, we couldn't appreciate y'all more. We love y'all. We thank you so much. As I always say, we really appreciate you, and we couldn't appreciate y'all enough, and all the love y'all show us. And of course, as I always love to say, all glory to God. That's right, for without him nothing is possible. All glory to our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And there's only one thing left to do. Ladies and gentlemen, for the first time here on The Defining Moment, it's time to bring it home. Fun one today, y'all. I'll tell you, we have frenzy all over the place. It has been without a doubt a fun show talking about all the moves in the NFL. We didn't get March Madness this year, but I'll tell you what, we definitely got NFL March Madness, the NFL version. And I hope you're enjoying it, because the new year just started in the NFL. Oh boy, Tom Brady, he's wearing different colors, the pewter and red. How is that going to look over there in Tampa Bay? Nick Foles going to Chicago, what? Ah, Chicago, oh yeah, I see you. And to everybody else who doesn't think that's a real deal with him going over there, are you tripping? Anyway, that's going down for today. That was a lot of fun with our new segments. Also, we got a little bit into some boxing. Golovkin, Canelo 3. I'm taking Canelo. Hopefully it happens this year. But I'll tell you, I think it's going to be quite the fight. Oh, yes. Also on the docket, will we get sports back? I don't know. Will we get sports back with no fans? I don't know, but I don't really want to see that. I'll probably still watch it, but I don't know. Anyway, that was a real thing today. And of course, I've got to show all the love I can to the mastermind behind UCR basketball. My guest on today's show, I got to show him some love, y'all. One more time, can we get a hand clap for head coach of UC Riverside men's basketball, Coach David Patrick. Oh yes. Thank you, Coach, for listening. We appreciate you, man. That was a lot of fun. Oh, it was a lot of fun talking to him. With that said, this is going to close out another day, another show here on IE Sports Radio. We're keeping it rocking and rolling. We have the IE Sports Radio March Madness type of tournaments coming on. Who was the greatest driver? The greatest fighter? The greatest sports teams in history? We'll be getting those votes coming up next week. Also, the Fan of the Month will be announced coming up later on today. Mm-hmm. Be ready for that. Stay tuned to our website. Once again, stay tuned to our website at iesportsradio.com. Check us out on all major platforms for podcasting, all except Pandora, but that's coming soon. Also, well, at least I hope so. Gotta reapply to them. But check us out on all social media. Twitter at iesportsradio. Also Instagram at iesportsradio. Oh yeah. And Facebook. Give us a like if you'd like. We'd certainly like that. Check us out. Show us some love. You can follow me and boy there. Be at @thee_lb53. You know what the deal is. Big shout out to the chat room. Y'all know. Terrence says here, the Big West Women's Basketball Tournament went on before it got canceled and it had no fans in the stands. Basically, it was so quiet the players could hear the broadcasters. Talk about weird. Yeah, absolutely. And he says, holy mother. upbeat/blues jazz. That track is popping like popcorn. It certainly is. And you know what that means. On that note, thanks, Taryn. Thank you to Taryn, to Couch Crew Chief Jonathan in the chat room, and for Mr. Marcus Davidson earlier. Appreciate y'all. I'll see y'all next week. Until then, this is me, your boy, Larry B, signing off. I'll see y'all next week. Until then, take care. As always, God bless.